You are now checked in to Stand Up New York Labs. Oh, yeah.
Very serious.
This is the Mandatory Sampson Podcast, coming to you live from Stand Up New York Labs in New York City. Hi, everyone. My name is Chris Flannery. I'm joined by a pretty good guy, Joey Noe.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, of course. Also being produced by the one and only Shelby. Shelby, say hi to the people.
What up, what up?
Yeah, there you go.
Thank you, Shelby.
Excellent drop-in, Shelby. Evan, I'm told, will be arriving in a little bit. We'll see what happens.
Okay.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the program. Full GOP debate coverage at the end of this program.
Nice.
Are you excited about that?
Very excited.
A few stories at the beginning, including two quick hits about Obama and Guantanamo Bay that I found interesting because it's something that we've been talking about a little bit recently. And an interesting little follow-up to last week's Israel-Palestine conflict that we were talking about.
Oh, yes.
It's just telling. You read it, right? I sent you the notes.
Yes.
You checked it out.
I did read it.
It's interesting. Then we're going to examine two videos. The first is Zachary Hammond getting shot by a cop during a $50 pot bust. We talked about this a while ago, I think it's MSP53. It was the one with Yamanika. I think that's where we brought it up at first. We might have done a follow-up on that. I'm not sure. But more information about that. And the video of the shooting came out, and it's terrible.
It's a terrible video.
You didn't see.
Correct. I have not seen that.
All right. The second is a cop attacking a teenager in Spring Valley High School in South Carolina, which is a video that's obviously been making the rounds there.
Super viral, yes.
Yes. So we're going to get into that. But first, ready for this?
Mm-hmm.
We're going to give some shout-outs and read some emails, one of which applies to the South Carolina incident later in the show that we're going to get to. I'm going to read the email now,
okay, and
then we'll bring it back up later again. Before we get to the emails, I want to say this. Nika Taylor on YouTube, mm-hmm. You can go to youtube.com/mandatorySampson, watch the show stream live every Thursday at 4 p.m. or you can check out full episode video, which I also put up. She wants me to do my Joey impression.
What?
And she wants you to read from 50 Shades of Grey.
We can do that.
Yeah, we could probably make that happen. I feel like, I mean, you know, look, if I'm feeling a little froggy, maybe I'll leap. I'll read some 50 Shades of Grey. I'll bust it out once in a while. I haven't actually been doing it, right?
No, you have not. That's true.
Delgado Digital on YouTube. He did a great, he's commenting on like a lot of the YouTube videos, which is really cool.
Oh, thank you.
But he did a really nice like rundown of the last episode with like timed highlights. So like he'll make a comment with like a little, you can click on it and you can go to that part of the episode. Very cool.
I
really like that rundown. I really appreciate the support. Very cool. I want to shout out Lauren on Snapchat. She snapped me and said, is it a problem that I get all my news from the Mandatory Sampson Podcast?
Absolutely not.
That's exactly what I told her. I was like, no, I think that's probably a really good idea, and I'm totally okay with it. All right, so then we got these two emails that I... Oh, by the way,
yes.
Fuck up of the week?
Do not have one.
You don't have one, yeah. We talked about it. We got a lot of the debate coverage we're going to get into.
Yes.
You do have an interesting story, though, something that people who've listened to the show the entire time will know about.
Yep.
What do you got, Joey?
It's a quick update on GamerGate.
Yeah, fantastic.
Every tone.
GamerGate, which I still don't understand, but I still really love. You're going to get into that in a little bit. Now, I wanted to read these emails really quick before we get into any of that stuff. We got an email from my friend Kyle. Obviously, I'm not going to say the last names because I don't know, whatever. But mm-hmm. Kyle says, hey, Chris and Joey, just wanted to let you guys know you're killing it. Kyle,
nice.
Great way to start an email. Going to
yes,
be honest
thank
with you.
You.
I really enjoy that. I'm a senior in high school, and your podcast has taught me more about current events than any other class I've taken in high school.
Wow.
Which, not good that high school isn't teaching it. Good for us.
Yes.
But I'd rather that the high school be teaching you more than I am. But I take that as a compliment. I really appreciate that. He says, not sure if you've thought about it before, but you guys are helping to influence the future voters of this country.
Oh, my God.
Well, I'll tell you what. I have thought about it. No, I mean, I emailed him and I was like, no, it's not really something that I'm thinking about. But I do. That is part of the rationale behind doing the show. Obviously, it's fun.
Yes.
I enjoy getting into this stuff. But I think it's important to put out different ideologies or whatever, my opinion on the news and kind of, you know, see where it goes. So I really think it's cool that Kyle's appreciating what we're putting down here. He also says, listen to this. This is directed at you. Did you read this email?
I did.
Joey?
Yes.
I think you contribute to the podcast way more than 10% and should rap more.
Well, thank you, and let me say thank you.
Yeah, people really enjoyed your rap. Somebody commented that they think it was brilliant that you rhyme shock with shock on the last episode, which I also think is great. He says, keep killing it, guys. I'll try to send some spare cash your way if you have the funds. No, don't do that. You're in high school. Save your money.
Yes.
Nobody has to spend any money on the show. If you want to donate, you can. You can go on Stand Up New York Labs, standupnylabs.com, entertainment section, find the podcast, and you can donate on there. Not necessary, but we appreciate it. If you do donate, I'll send you a mandatory Sampson sticker, a bunch of stickers. So that's a little incentive if you want to. But please don't worry about it. Kyle, thank you very much for the support. Really appreciate it. Stuff like that really warms my heart, Joey.
Yeah, it definitely warms mine.
We got another email from Alejandro. And now this is the one that's going to relate to the story that we have a little bit later.
Okay.
I'm going to read it. We can, you know, bat it around a little bit, and then we'll get into the show. Chris and Joey, what's up? You guys digging the show per usual. Well, terrific. Thank you. Just wanted to bring some points home real quick against your stance, Chris, on the Oregon shooting. Pardon the late response. I hope you're still willing to discuss it on the upcoming show. He actually sent it last week.
Oh, okay.
He tried to get it in right before we normally recorded 4, which he did. He got it to me at 3:15, but we recorded a 2 last week, so I missed it.
Oh, okay.
Whatever. So doesn't matter. I figured I'd bring it up. He says, to get right to it, I cannot at all agree with your idea of more casualties if we place some sort of armed guard there for protection, and somehow that would make it worse. Now, like we talked about with all the school shootings and stuff, part of the idea being put out there is that if we had more armed guards in school, perhaps even a cop in every classroom, this would lessen the amount of...
Yeah.
Okay, let me finish with the email and then we can answer some of it. Sounds to me like you're pretty much saying, quote, let's just let this guy go all out and kill as many of us as he likes, and we'll just sit and wait until he's done. That's not what I'm saying. That's not what... Well, what? Good.
That's not what we're saying.
Well, I mean, you can take... Fine, you can take it that way. I think that... Probably, sure. In some circumstances, you're going to get a cop there that is 100% alert, very accurate. And by very accurate, we're talking 50%. That's a legitimate, that's a very high number, 50% shoot, you know, accuracy. You're going to get a guy that's really trained and really appropriate for the situation. And he's going to happen to be in the classroom that a gunman comes in, and he's going to be able to potentially stop this guy before anything bad happens. The problem is, if you're talking about putting a cop in every classroom or arming all schools in America or whatever it is, you're not going to be dealing with the cream of the crop in all cases.
No.
You're not going to be dealing with guys that are always alert or in shape or doing what, you know, that becomes the problem. I'm not saying that it can't work one, you know, like it would work in some instances, absolutely. But to me, the broad amount of, you know, the possibility of it going poorly is probably more likely than not in a lot of cases.
Also, the other thing, too, I just thought about, the expense that would be required for this would be astronomical.
Totally. That doesn't even have to... You're right, but that doesn't even have to enter into it. We're just talking completely practically. But right, of course. I mean, to be able to put a cop in every classroom is going to be absolutely insane. If you can't guess what story this is going to relate to later, just hang on. Sure, an extra gun there might increase chances of innocent bystanders being shot, but at least give the people a chance at some protection. Guaranteed, if you were in such a situation, wouldn't you want some cop there with a gun? I'm sure any policeman or woman would be happy to put a few bullets in the crazed asshole trying to shoot innocent civilians. One more thing, if you're showing police are inaccurate shooters, what's the point of calling them at all? Give the cops a break, man. They're not all power tripping dickheads. Of course, they're not all power tripping dickheads. And the reason why you call the police is because, I mean, I get his point there, right? It's like, yes, if you think that the cops are totally, they can't shoot straight and all this stuff, why bother?
Have them
there? Yeah, but that's, but obviously, you know, that we're not playing a zero sum game here. We're talking about the cop being at a place already waiting for trouble to come, as opposed to a fucking guy just broke into my house. I need a cop to come, and he's definitely, you know what I mean? It's like a one-on, it's a few people involved. At a school, you're talking chaos when something like this goes down. That's the element, I think, that gets lost in the shuffle, where it's like, no, all the kids are just going to sit calmly, and if there's a cop there, then he's just going to shoot the bad guy. Like, no, there should be protocols in place that could, you know, and there are in a lot of schools, I think, where you get onto the desks or you get up against the wall, lock the doors and all this stuff.
Closets.
So, you know, there is stuff in place. It's not like you're just going to sit there and be sitting ducks. But in some instances, what are you realistically going to do? I think there was cops at some of the places where shootings go down. People still do get killed. To think that you're going to be able to fit them into every classroom and stop everything is bizarre. But, yeah, they're not all power-tripping dickheads.
No, not at all.
I get that.
And also you have the cross-file possibility, too, which is the worst thing you could do with everyone freaked out running around.
Oh, that's what I'm talking about. It's just going to be like chaos. Little Joe Harary hates the word bedlam, but it would be bedlam. So he wraps up his email. He says, another point, the chill factor. I think if college students saw an armed police officer patrolling their campus, it shouldn't scare them. It would probably put them at ease that there is someone there to protect them. The fact that there has been, there have been so many school mass shootings lately is the real chill factor here. I don't know about that. I mean, to me, we saw during like Occupy Wall Street and like different protests like that, where the cop on campus just comes in and like pepper sprays kids because they're sitting in the, you know, I again, and we're going to see it later with this high school situation. It all, everything always starts out really well intentioned, that the cop is there just to protect, mm-hmm. not discipline or do anything like that. But we see that that isn't the case. It's in a perfect world, sure, the cops are all benevolent and they're there and they're paying attention and they're good
and nothing
to go.
Ever happens,
right? But that to me seems a little far fetched, and I think that's what you have to be leery of. I'm not discounting the fact that in some cases, sure, it might help, it might save some lives, it might save all the lives there, but I just don't see that happening repeatedly, especially with the amount of shootings that we have. You know, like that's also what's getting lost in the shuffle. There's you know, whatever. There's one a week in this country, mass shootings at a school. That's the bigger problem. Like, that's not happening because there's no cops at schools. That's happening because there's a gun problem and there's mm-hmm. potentially, you know, a problem with mental illness in the country. That's really the issue. Anyway, do you got anything to say about that?
And you too. And the funny thing about it is you could have cops in as many classrooms and you're still going to have that one classroom that's not going
to
have it.
Of course, right. So realistically, you'd have to, I mean, not really realistically, but yeah, you'd have to put a cop in every classroom to really
make every
this,
grade and yeah. everything would be.
But then you're talking about having a whole police department at a high school. It's like, and then what happens when the kid, you know, the sophomore is like buying weed? Oh, now is the cop going to get involved? Is he only there to protect him? Like, that becomes the issue. This becomes the issue with God.
Yeah, because the cops might want to step in, and then you have the bullying thing too.
Sure, great point. Right, absolutely. Right, that's
so,
the thing.
Because now, how does someone who is an authoritative
authority figure?
Yes, thank you. There, and you have the kids bullying each other. Then, is it their place to tell the kids don't be doing that? Because that would have to come up.
Totally. And that's again, right. You're absolutely right. And these are all things that would be factored in. If the cops could all be there, I mean, and really be like laser focused, like they're at like Westminster Abbey, you know, like they don't talk to anybody. They just look straight ahead. And the only thing they're there for is to stop potential mass shootings. Mm-hmm. Fine. But you know, that's not going to be the situation. It's just not going to be. He says, anyway, excuse any grammatical errors here. I'm on the clock at work. Just wanted to get this out before the next show. Thank you. I really appreciate that. You did get it in before the show. We switched the time on you, so that's not your fault. I appreciate your email. It says, P.S., get on the Bill Maher show. You got my vote. Well, thank you, Alejandro. Aww. I really appreciate that. You know, that's the cool thing about people that email in, and feel free to email in, mandatorysampson@gmail.com. I respond to all of them. Sometimes read them on the show. A lot of the time, I get an email where it's like, I don't agree with you, but we like what you're doing with the show. You guys are not presenting it in an unfair way. That's awesome. Like, that's really cool. I mean, obviously, Kyle loves it, and I love you,
and
Kyle.
Getting feedback is amazing, so thank you, guys.
Yeah, it feels really good. Get a lot of tweets and everything. Emily tweeted me today. It's just like, it's great. This is the feedback is awesome. I love you guys. I really appreciate it. Alrighty. Oh, by the way, Evan showed up here. Evan, step to the mic a second. Evan just rolled in.
What up?
Yeah, there you go. What's up, Evan? How you doing, man?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm good.
The Conway jersey.
Thank you. I appreciate you noticing.
Banks, because Conway was a spoiled asshole.
Well, he was the captain of the team, and he was Bombay's favorite. Get away from the microphone. All right. If you guys want to see what he's talking about, check out the video on YouTube later tonight. Joe, you ready to get into? You know what? Why don't you do the goddamn GamerGate update?
You want
to
do this?
Yeah, I'm so excited about it. Explain to the Samsonites and the nobodies and everybody what, like, why are we even talking about GamerGate still? For people that, since this is their first episode, why are we talking about GamerGate?
All right, so GamerGate went away. Like, for the most part, they weren't talking about it.
But what was it? It was like a little, what was it? Like, explain. It was like a protest movement or whatever. Briefly.
Okay, so virtually what happened was you have a bunch of people who were gamers who were attacking different aspects of the gamer culture, such as journalism, such as individual feminists, and different things. It was a whole melting pot. We went over it in Depression Quest, episode 2.
Wow, I love that you pulled the title out. Yeah, MSP2, Depression Quest, which is a terrible game created by one of the women that was getting attacked by like these like nutty gamers.
Zoe Quinn.
Zoe Quinn, right. Wow. This you remember. Like, shit we talked about 25 minutes ago. You're like, no, nope. Not there. I don't know.
So GamerGate, for the most part, settled down. Adam Baldwin was part of it.
Right.
Now what ended up happening is every year there's a festival, South by Southwest, which does music, film,
comedy. There's a lot of
interactive festival and video games.
Right.
So this is for next year, okay? It's not even this year, and it got blown out of proportion.
All right.
So for next year, there was supposed to be two panels.
Really? It's for next year? Are you sure?
Yes, it was for next year.
Unreal. Okay, good.
Okay, so the first one was a panel called Save Point, a discussion on gaming community.
Right.
And the second one was Level Up, Overcoming Harassment in Video Games.
Right. Which is all, again, like, that's what's crazy about this whole thing. It's all reasonable shit where it's like, listen, if women want to play video games, don't call them cunts all the time. And, like, don't yell at women that want to be in the gaming industry. Because that is the big thing with this thing, as we understand it. Again, if you've been listening to this show right from the beginning, you know that we've covered this a lot, and we still don't really understand what happened.
Nope, not at all.
But essentially, right, it's like, women in gaming get treated like shit, and there's somewhat of a bias against them on the production side, and blah, blah, blah. And that's sort of where this spawned from. But then you have people that take it way too far.
A lot of people have their own individual agendas.
Right. Well, it seems like the gamer, like, boys or whatever you want to call them, they don't like anybody coming into their club whatsoever. They just, like, love it too much, and they don't want any no girls allowed in the clubhouse.
So apparently, what is believed happened was that gamers of GamerGate found out that these two panels are happening. So a few of them decided to send numerous threats of on-site violence related to this programming.
Right.
So the head guy decided to call it off from even happening.
Wow. The head guy at South by Southwest, you mean? He's like, we're not even going to fuck around with this. See, don't be cowed by these little babies. They're not... They do threaten a lot, and I think it's legitimate for, you know, women that have spoken out to be you can't take it at face value and be like, oh, they're not actually going to show up at my house and kill my dog or cat or whatever it is. But, like, most of them are not going to. You're probably able to, like, track who these little fuckers are. Don't not do it because they're threatening you. It's sort of the same thing with, like, the Draw Muhammad contest. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what you're doing is going to antagonize a certain percentage of people, but fuck them. You know what I mean? It's like, that's the whole point of it. Don't.
Now, that's interesting that you even brought that up because an individual, Randy Harper, happens to be a gamer and author who goes out raising awareness about online abuse, engineering, and video game and development.
Online and booze.
Yes.
Check out the internet.
So now here's the interesting thing. She commented on Twitter that she was part of the panel. That we weren't involved in a GamerGate-related panel. Our panel was about design discussions and reporting systems and community management.
Okay.
So it's odd because she's saying that the panel had nothing to do with it, but she's created something about GamerGate.
Right.
So,
well, is she using GamerGate as the example? And when she says community, she doesn't mean, like, you know, a town that you live in. She means, like, a corporate community or whatever, like a group.
I think the internet community?
Yeah,
but that's so confused by what's actually happening.
I don't know, but it seems like she probably used GamerGate as, like, the example of a way to, like, maybe this is how you'd fix this situation or whatever, and then these little weirdos get upset about it.
So what she's done is she created a tool
all right,
called GamerGate Auto Blocker.
All right.
Okay?
I'm listening.
It turns out that it doesn't follow people's tweets, but she said it that if certain individuals are following two or more people who she deemed ringleaders of GamerGate,
sure,
it would automatically block them out.
Interesting. So you just cut them off at the pass.
Yes.
That's dangerous to an extent. I mean, whatever. It's not really that dangerous. It's less dangerous than, like, being threatened to, you know, somebody's going to kill and rape you or in whatever order they want to do that. Yeah, but that's interesting, though, that it would, like, track them and block them because that could be used the other way around. Mm-hmm. You know, that could be used in weird ways. But whatever, look, yeah, I mean, there's no reason to just accept that type of harassment. Like, it's not a reasonable conversation that you're having. I think it's important to talk to people that you don't agree with, but, right, like, when it comes to, like, the threat of violence, fuck off. Like, we don't have to talk.
The head guy, the head director was Hugh F. Forrest, apparently.
Okay.
And here's a quote. If people cannot agree, disagree, and embrace new ways of thinking in a safe and secure place that is free of online and offline harassment, then this marketplace of ideas inevitably is compromised.
Yeah. Yeah, well, of course. I mean, that's what I'm saying. I mean, if people are just going to And that, again, like I bring it back to the religious thing, or like the Islamic extremism or any kind of extremism, that becomes the problem. Like when you get so tied up in it and then you're just going to use violence, the threat of violence or actual violence as a threat against ideas, when mm-hmm. when you start putting physicality against mentality, like that becomes that's a real issue. And that's obviously what we're seeing here.
Now, this went viral because BuzzFeed and Vox Media stepped in.
Sure.
Because they normally have panels and they are very interactive with the festival. So they claim that if they don't do something to rectify the situation, they will withdraw from the festival.
Oh, okay. I mean, good for them that they're taking a little stand on it. Now, again, whether this thing is like the most important, I think it's a microcosm of what people are seeing broadly in culture and like mm-hmm. on the internet, where women are kind of treated shitty by a certain percentage of like people on men on the internet. Like, so they're using this as like the hill to go down on, which is fine. Is Gamergate the biggest deal? No, I don't think so.
No.
However, to the people that are involved in it, of course it is. And the people that are being threatened, it's a problem. So yeah, good. I mean, they're not going to pull out, by the way, but good. They should.
They said
they
would.
Have the fucking panel discussion. Why wouldn't you? Of course. You did a nice job with that.
Thank you.
You really covered the shit out of it, I would say.
Nice.
You feel good about it?
I feel great.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. You brought a lot of energy today. I'm a little sleepy. I'm going to be honest with you. I didn't get a ton of sleep, but you're
well, we're
going to
balance
it
out. We're going to balance it out.
I know. You're doing a hell of a job. Obama vetoes the NDAA. This is the first story we got, and I think it's a good one. Now, again, we're going to close this bad boy down with an in-depth Republican debate coverage. So I have a couple of stories at the beginning, but then we're going to get to those clips. I have it, like always, a nice rundown. For only the fifth time in his presidency, President Obama vetoed the National Defense Authorization Act, which is a military budget spending mm-hmm. bill situation. Primarily, this is what's interesting, why I wanted to bring it, vetoed it primarily over the fact that it contained language that would make it virtually impossible to close Gitmo.
Oh, they're sneaky.
Yeah, they are sneaky, but I like... Well, they always do this, right? The part of the language was that you wouldn't be able to put any of the prisoners, remaining prisoners, in United States prisons, which, by the way, it's like most of them don't need to be in prison, probably. Or you can't transfer them to any, you know, like other country where they might be from.
So what do you do with them?
Exactly. That's why they're doing it. So it's like, well, guess you just got to leave them in Guantanamo, like really cute. But Obama sent it back. Now, again, there's only the fifth time that he's vetoed anything like this, which is impressive. Mm-hmm. He threatened to veto this in 2011, 2012, and 2014. He backed down, but I actually have a clip of him now talking about why he felt it was necessary to veto this time, and I think it's important. Now, also, bear with us. It might get a little loud or whatever. I got to adjust the volume.
Okay.
I'm dealing with a new computer. As everybody knows, I had an issue last week, so I got a new one. It sounds a little different, so just bear with me, sweet Samsonites. I love you all, and I don't mean to hurt your ears. This is Obama talking about why he vetoed the NDAA. Let me just skip ahead to... where he's actually talking about it. God, he's a decent looking cat, no Obama.
Yes, he is.
What a weird, why did I even say that? Like, what a weird.
And the third thing is that.
Here we go. You comfortable
this
with
legislation
that?
Yeah, specifically good. Impedes our ability to close Guantanamo in a way that I have repeatedly argued is counterproductive to our efforts to defeat terrorism around the world. Guantanamo is one of the premier mechanisms for jihadists to recruit. It's time for us to close it. It is outdated, it's expensive, it's been there for years, and we can do better in terms of keeping our people safe while making sure that we are consistent with our values.
Yeah, which Guantanamo Bay, I mean, we've talked about it pretty much at length at this point, is not consistent with what you would consider American values.
No, but the exact opposite.
Yes.
So, I'm going to be vetoing this authorization bill. I'm going to be sending it back to Congress, and my message to them is very simple. Let's do this right. We're in the midst of budget discussions. Let's have a budget that properly funds our national security as well as economic security. Let's make sure that we're able in a constructive way to reform our military spending to make it sustainable over the long term, and let's make sure that in a responsible way, we can draw down the populations in Guantanamo, make sure that the American people are safe, and make sure that we're not providing the kinds of recruitment tools to terrorists that are so dangerous.
So that's also what I liked at the end there. He ties it up really nicely by saying it's a recruiting tool, and that's exactly correct. That is not something that it's made up. That is propaganda. Well, it's not even propaganda because they're not making it up, but this is stuff that you hear when they're trying to recruit terrorists. They say they use Guantanamo as one of the main, like, look what they're doing to our brothers and whatever. You know, that's legitimate. So I think that's nice that he did it. What happens from here, who knows, but this is not a symbolic thing that he's doing. This is, I believe, with the intention of actually trying to wrap up Guantanamo Bay. And, you know,
I have a question for you. How many times do you think he said, let's do this right? Because I have a feeling that says it way too much.
Yeah.
And also, it should be something that shouldn't need to be said.
Yeah. I mean, he just probably putters around at night just in his slippers, just like, let's do this right. Like when dealing with Congress. Yeah, of course. Yeah. I mean, it's probably a constant struggle for him. Like, can we just do this right? People like Mo Obama, Joey.
You're doing it well.
Let's do it right. John Boehner. Boehner's gone. It's Eric Cantor now. No, it's not. Paul Ryan. Paul Ryan.
All right.
We're going to go back to Chicago. All right. I'm not going to do it every week, but it's good. Dude, close Gitmo. Okay. That's Obama yelling.
Yes.
Close Guantanamo Bay. Me and Michelle. That's when he's like a little more relaxed. Going to go to Uno Pizza, Chicago. Okay. Israel's use of the word terrorist. You ready for this? This is,
yes, I am.
It's very interesting. This comes from the Intercept, which I love. That's like probably my, it's such a weird thing to say my favorite. It's like my favorite thing to read, but it's like they have really solid foreign policy, you know, foreign, a lot of stuff that I really
enjoy.
It's
a favorite website?
Yeah, it's a great place to go. I like the way that it's written. I like the people that are doing the work there. And they attack stuff from, they attack it hard.
They
go for it. But then also what they're putting out there is like, has a different kind of
vibe.
Yeah, I was going to say a different kind of like slant as the way that like the mainstream,
quote,
mainstream media would cover, you know, these types of issues.
So you were going to get into that, right? The whole bias about the mainstream.
Yeah, I love that you brought that up. I was just going to say, What a weirdo situation that Republican debate was, where they kept going. I mean, that's a classic, you know, conservative trope where it's like, oh, the entire media is biased against us. But yeah, I have a lot of that, you know, in the run.
Every anchor is against us.
Yeah, it just doesn't make sense. And I have that. We'll get into it. Okay. But right, of course, there is a legitimacy to the fact that the main, quote, mainstream, whatever, you know, the network news, different stuff like that. Yeah, there's a bit of a bias, but I think it's biased towards. It might be a little bit more liberal. However, I think the real bias is towards power, which is the big problem, influence and power, because they run on ad dollars, which comes from big corporations. Mm-hmm. And they also, like Glenn Greenwald has pointed out a number of times, their sources are people within the administration. So if they're going to attack the administration and go after it, they're not going to get the quote they need, or they're not going to get the access they need. So that's where the bias is, if anything. Okay. The Jerusalem Post reported last week that two Israeli Defense Force soldiers killed a man, quote, believed to be an Arab terrorist. He was acting erratically and tried to grab their guns. Turns out he was an Israeli Jew. Now, this is where it gets interesting. Mm-hmm. I have this paragraph from the Jerusalem Post. Let's read it. Only after the man was neutralized was it made clear that he was a Jew from Jerusalem, police concluded. Zaka Rescue, which is Z-A-K-A, which I guess is whatever, their like emergency service. Zaka Rescue and Recovery Chairman Yehuda Mishi Zahav, I probably didn't say that right, who was at the scene, said he also initially thought the suspect was an Arab terrorist. Quote, when I arrived with the Zaka team at the site of the supposed terrorist attack, it seemed to be a, quote, standard current terrorist attack, a stabbing attempt, and the terrorist was apprehended. I wanted to cover the body in a black bag, which is reserved for terrorists only. Mm-hmm. After I was asked to take care of the body, I saw that he was a Jew and that it was a mistake to speak of a terrorist. I immediately notified the police and we switched to a white Zaka body bag. So
can I ask the question?
By all means.
So probably going to get heat for this, but does that mean that someone who's Jewish can't be a terrorist by definition?
Well, this is, I mean, this is what he's saying is, right, if this guy was Arab,
yes,
Palestinian, and was doing it, terrorist. The fact that he's a Jew from Jerusalem, no, he's not, doesn't mean that Jews can't be terrorists. But in Jerusalem, it seems like that's going to be the case. And it also speaks to, because if you read the article, it gets into that the word terrorist is just thrown around. It's just kind of it's a meaningless term. Because 10 minutes earlier, the guy's a terrorist. 10 minutes later, no, he's just a fallen Israeli Jew. You know what I mean? Like, it's a very fluid use of the word terrorist. And what does it really mean? Like, when we talk about
different body bag is what it means.
Well, absolutely right. It's simply a label depending on context. Shocker Ammer, people would call him a terrorist. The guy's not a terrorist. He's in Guantanamo Bay. He's not a terrorist, but he's a terrorist, right? It's like, well, okay, so what's the deal? And it also, in the article, I think it quoted Rudy Giuliani saying, you know, when he was talking about torture, is waterboarding torture, and he says it depends who's doing the waterboarding.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That's exactly the case
it's
here.
Context.
Is he a terrorist? Well, it depends where he's from.
Now,
that's legitimate. I mean, that's a legitimate bias, and that speaks, I think, to the culture kind of in Jerusalem. I mean, it makes sense. We do the same shit. You know, we don't want to call... Well, whatever. Go ahead.
So... I would like to know if he was an immediate threat and needed to be put down because he reached for the guns.
Well, it's interesting.
That's my question.
Right, you're saying because they read him as Arab, so they went after him.
But if he was possibly identified as a Jew later, shouldn't he have been identified that at the moment that the action occurred?
I guess. I mean, you don't know.
Really, at the moment, you didn't have
time. Yeah, if the guy's running around with a knife or whatever. I mean, I understand that tensions would be high then if the people are getting stabbed in Israel. Like, I get that. I'm not saying that they shouldn't probably be on alert about that shit. Whatever. If the guy's got a knife and he's acting crazy and he tries to grab your gun, like, okay.
Yeah.
That'd be justified in America. Like, if somebody has a knife and is trying to grab your gun. Okay, fine. Then maybe you can probably shoot that guy. I probably feel good about that. Not good about it, but I think that's legitimate. Anyway, just an interesting, little bit of a distinction there. And it's an interesting thing to think about. When you see the word terrorist, read up a little bit about it. Don't just take it at face value because it is used subjectively.
See, to me, the word then loses meaning if we're going to throw it around that easily.
Absolutely. And that's part of the argument all along, like in the United States, where we're constantly talking about terrorists, or we say... It used to be Al-Qaeda. We used to be like, oh, Al-Qaeda's the Taliban, whatever. Now it's ISIS. But it's just an interchangeable term that means like crazy group of people that hate us. You know what I mean? And I'm doing air quotes. It's like,
yeah.
But we're just using different ways. It doesn't really matter. It's just there's a threat out there. And that's the phrase we're using for now.
The fact that...
What, Joey?
No, it's just it's shocking to me that you... can say one group of people can automatically be a terrorist.
Of course, because if you're predisposed to, that's the way that your mind's going to work.
And the other group is not, just because it's a group of people. Well, it just blows my mind.
Yeah, it's very fascinating, but it's also what we were talking about recently where, you know, with the drone strike thing, where people are not, they don't even know their names. They just know them as a number, they're a target, and that's it. Like, it's dehumanizing. That's what it does, and that's why it makes it a lot easier to commit different atrocities against people or, not care about the collateral damage. Yeah, because they're not really a person.
It's just a number.
Yeah, it's not whatever this guy's name is. They didn't release the name, but it's like, nope, that's a terrorist. You know what I mean? It's just very easy. It's just, once you get in your head the terrorist is bad and you call everybody a terrorist, then everybody over there is bad. You don't have to really do any math.
Yeah.
That is very dangerous. That's the problem. All right. Zachary Hammond. Now, for people that don't know this story, we did bring it up on the Yamanika episode, but I feel like we kind of, maybe got lost in the shuffle a little bit. I don't know, remember if we brought it up again. I feel like we did, but I'm not sure. White kid, I think 19 years old. I'm not really sure. I think 19 years old. Young. Driving a car with another person who they were going to sell weed in like a parking lot or something. Like it said a bag of weed. I think I read a couple times, $50, whatever it is. Even if it's, a half ounce of marijuana, it's not a big deal. So... they're going to sell this weed. He's driving. Turns out that it was a fucking sting operation that they had set up to like get this, this Pablo Escobar type. Yeah. which is absurd. So he shows up there and they were like, oh fuck, it's a cop. So the cop has his gun drawn already. I have the video. Oh. We're going to play the video. Has the gun drawn and he's telling, obviously, Zachary Hammond to stop moving the car. The car's parked.
Mm-hmm.
However, when he sees the cop, I guess he freaked out. Fine. Not fine, but I understand him freaking out. He tries to back the car out. He does. And as he starts to drive away, the cop just pumps shots into him and kills him dead, which to me doesn't seem like the proper response to that. Perhaps shoot the tires.
There's
a number of things you could do instead of
use protocol.
Putting your arm directly into the car, much like we saw with Samuel DeBose.
Mm-hmm.
you know, it's a similar situation. So let's watch this video. And again, guys, this is all readily available stuff. However, we have it up on a TV here that we're watching. And if you watch on YouTube, you can check it out along with us. So this is the Zachary Hammond shooting, Joey, and we'll check it out. It's 20 seconds, so maybe we'll just let it play. All right. Meanwhile, this cop like fucking flies in. You're hearing that. Why? It's a bag of weed. It's like an ape.
It's a sting operation. You gotta go sting.
It's so crazy. Yeah, I know. Because this kid's like, he must. It just doesn't. It blows my mind that this is even a thing that is occurring. All right. So now the car is parked. The car that Zachary Hammond is driving is parked. The cop car is directly behind it, and the cop you're about to see in a second, he's gonna jump out. Okay, he's out already
with the gun drawn.
Gun drawn. 19-year-old in the car selling weed. All right, he's not doing anything more than that. Seems unnecessary. All right, now Zachary Hammond backs the car out a little bit, and he's gonna try to pull away. Okay. The cop gets right next to it. The cop is maybe 3 feet from the car at this point. The car hasn't moved again. It backed out, stopped. The cop's 3 feet away from it. Now Hammond turns the car, tries to accelerate a little bit. I mean, he's not going that fast. Pulls to the left. The cop is close enough that he's touching the door. All right? Now, at this point, Joey and Shelby and whoever, you guys can jump in on this. Does this cop seem like he's in imminent danger here? Does he seem like he's about to be hit by this car?
Not at all.
No, not no imminent danger for the cop.
Right. Yeah. Okay, fair enough. Yeah, I just want to... Okay. So now the car keeps driving a little bit. The cop still calmly takes like 3 steps backwards. He's not... His feet are not even close to the tires. He's got the gun right in the window of the car, and you're about to see the tragedy that's about to unfold. And that's it. Now he's killed the kid. So the cop... Like, let me say this. The South Carolina police officer, Lieutenant Mark Tiller, won't face charges because he claimed he feared for his life and the prosecution agreed with him. Now, we just watched
the same video.
Let's watch it in full motion real quick, and then we can get into... I have some quotes and we can talk about it. But to me, it just... This one's a disaster.
They watched the same video.
Of course, yeah. Because he's protected. He can do whatever he wants because that kid's dangerous and that's a problem.
With a bag of marijuana.
We also talked about this. The cop lied about it. He said that, you know, he felt like he was going to get killed and that he shot him in a certain way. He wasn't going to get killed. That's nonsense. All right, here we go. Let's just watch it real quick and then we'll talk about it. Jesus. Wow.
There's no threat.
There's no threat there. I mean, the cop is easily able to avoid the car. The kid was not trying to hit him with the car.
Certainly not.
He was just trying to get the fuck out of there. He panicked. Which, bad move. Obviously, don't, you know, just whatever. You're not going to go to jail for the rest of your life.
The gun should have even been drawn.
But that's also part of it, right? Why the fuck is that gun drawn? That's going to freak you out more than the cop being like, look, we got you. You know what I mean?
Yeah, please stay in the car.
Yeah, you're going to get a fine because it's a little bit of weed. It's not a huge deal. So these are so fucked up, that video, which is great. It's not great that happened, but it's great that the video came out because we've read accounts of it. And yes. I've kind of been staying on top of it. And this video obviously is pretty clear. The terrible part is that this fucking cop is not in trouble at all. He's going to get off here. Greg Dietrich, the Seneca City administrator, this is his quote about the Zachary Hammond thing. The past 3 months have been extremely difficult for the residents of Seneca, its city employees, and the 45 members of its police force. Why does that town need 45 cops or whatever? That's insane. While the effects of outside agitators to tear apart our community lingers, we are thankful the investigation has come to an end and shows Lieutenant Tiller was acting in self-defense. Yeah. The night of July 26th was a tragic event for this community, and I personally will always grieve for the Hammond family. Sure, but meanwhile, you're going to sit there and tell them that was self-defense.
Bullshit. It's just bullshit.
It's absolutely mental. I mean, I don't understand how that goes down. You guys should check out that video. It's really, it's not graphic other than you see somebody shoot a gun. You don't see see the kid. But yeah, I mean, terrible, right? Like,
19 years old, a bag of pot in the car.
Right. What is the point there? Why did that need to be stopped? I mean, I get if you're going to arrest, I mean, whatever. I don't think you should be arrested, but if you're going to do it, that's not the way to handle it. You certainly don't need a sting operation. The next thing is the Spring Valley. We have this, and then just a quick one quick thing I want to say about Ben Carson before we get into the debate stuff. So we're right there. Spring Valley High School police brutality is what I headline this thing. South Carolina Sheriff's Deputy Ben Fields has been fired by Richland County Sheriff's Department over his actions taken against a 16-year-old female student who just happens to be black. Does that matter? Maybe. We're going to bring up some stuff at the end. Mm-hmm. She was caught looking at her phone by the teacher of the class.
How do you feel about that? Should the kids have phones?
Yeah, I mean, what are you going to do? Look, I found what...
They're there to study and to learn, not to be playing with their cell phones.
I hear you. When we were in high school, I didn't have a phone until junior year, I guess.
I didn't have a phone in high school.
Okay, see, so there's probably... Kyle that's listening is like, pow, what are you talking about? No, but because I got my car junior year. So it was sort of like, all right, you know, you need a phone, you know, whatever. It's like that type of thing, but it wasn't a commonplace thing. So it wasn't that prevalent when we were in high school. However, yeah, I think kids can have their phone. We certainly found ways to fuck around. You know what I mean? Like if it wasn't looking at the phone, it was me and Carl like passing like stupid ass drawings that we did and like passing back and forth doing all the shit.
Or everybody
Carl's
had that.
Carl's my friend.
Yes. Or everybody had the TSI 88 or whatever it was. And
oh,
we were
sure.
Playing
games. The stupid calculator. Right. Yeah. Exactly. I mean, I do remember playing like Snake quite a bit on my phone. Although not really. I wasn't really a phone guy because it wasn't like having Twitter or anything. I mean, if I had Twitter, forget it. Yeah. I probably wouldn't be paying attention. However.
The world would have been so different.
I would draw and like do different shit. But yes, I think kids should have their phone. If they're not going to pay attention, they're going to find a way not to pay attention, mm-hmm. regardless of whether they have their phone or not. Now, if it becomes crazy where they're like on, like talking on the phone or like really obvious, I'd be like, come on, can't you fucking pay attention for a half hour? But there's different ways to go about it. Anyway, so I guess there's a policy here, mm-hmm. where they're not supposed to be on their phone, which makes sense, but of course they're going to be. The teacher then tried to take the phone away. The student refused and was then told to leave the class. She also refused, which is when Ben Fields was summoned. Okay,
Mr. Fields.
We have the video. You think we should just play the video real quick?
Do you have the long video or the short video?
It's a 15-second video.
Okay.
Why? How long? There's a much longer video?
Not much longer, but apparently there's one where he walks into the room. It's a little different, but it's not
okay,
that important.
Okay, but whatever. We can basically see what happens. So we just gave you the little breakdown. Definitely check out this video. I'm sure you've seen it, but let's just watch it, Joey, and then we can kind of get into some quotes and different things that I have. Okay. So, I mean, immediately, it just doesn't seem necessary what he's doing. He's got her in a chokehold. I mean, he's got his arm around her neck, and he's got her other arm and from behind, and he's going to fuck this chick up because he's an asshole. Ah, he's yanking her around in the desk. Flips her. Now she's on her back in the desk. Like, what an animal. This is a fucking... This reminds me of the guy at the bikini, you know, the party.
Yes.
The bikini party. What a moron I am. The pool party.
The pool party.
The girl in the bikini that he fucking flipped like a maniac. All right, let's just finish it up here. I mean, it's very quick. Drags her and fucking tosses her across the room. To me, that is what gets that guy off. Like, he that's fucking fun for him. He likes doing that.
He had to subdue her.
Yeah, I know. He had to subdue her because she was being so riotous looking at her cell phone mm-hmm. in a classroom. You know, there's so many different ways that you could handle that situation. And again, this is what I wanted to bring up. This is obviously where the email relates, Alejandro's email. That's a cop in a school. Now, I understand that the way that you are saying it, that's obviously not what you mean when you say that you want a cop in the school. You think it would be, you know, as a protection means against a mass shooting. Fine, I totally understand that. But you have to understand from my point of view that that's a cop in a school. And I guarantee you that's not the rationale why he's supposed to be there, that he's supposed to yank unruly children out of their desks because their cell phones are out. Like, that wasn't what they envisioned, but that is clearly what happened there.
And then the other thing that if you're going to follow logical thinking, so the cop is there to remove her. What happens after he removes her? Does he bring her down to the police office because he was summoned? Or does he bring her down to the principal's office as a bodyguard?
Right.
So I'm confused on what would have been the correct way to handle this situation.
Absolutely. Now, she did get arrested. And a lot of people have pointed out, like, you know, that I've been talking to about it or I've seen conversations about it where the other students didn't jump up or do anything. Well, part of the reason why is they said they were in shock.
Right.
Obviously. It's crazy.
And what are they
number two,
do?
Right. It's a cop. This also goes back to my point that it becomes this larger than life authority figure that I don't think is going to make you feel chill. Like, to use Alejandro's quote, it's going to probably put you in a state of fear to an extent, a low level, because you know when something like this happens, you'd want to be like, whoa, what the fuck are you doing? Which somebody did. He got arrested. This becomes the problem. So now you've created, in the attempt, I think, to make the safe space, you've created it to be a place of fear now where potential discipline goes beyond just going to the principal's office. It's going down to jail in handcuffs. You know, like...
For looking at your cell phone.
That's the... Right. And that's really the problem. Well, not putting away your cell phone, not leaving the class, being disrespectful. But that's always been a thing that is true of schools. Like, things that have... Sometimes there's a kid that's just not in the fucking mood that day and they're going to be a little dick, you know? Like, yeah. It is what it is. You know, it shouldn't come with violence. On Race Wars last night, we were over there. Kurt Metzger was talking about, like, why, or maybe it was Sherrod on the phone. Sherrod was on the phone. But anyway, it's like, take the other kids out of the class then. Like, take all the, if it's already disrupting that you need to pull this cop in to, like, mm-hmm. yank her out of the state, why not let all the other kids leave the room? Now you talk to her one-on-one and be like, what are you doing? What is going
on? That is a very interesting way to handle that.
Of course. And it's nonviolent.
Like, hey, everybody gets recess. You have an issue. Let's resolve this issue like adults, even though you're a minor and we apparently have to treat you like one.
Of course. Right. So, all right. So that's fucked up. But that's an interesting point that those guys brought up. And I think it makes sense. Richland County Sheriff Leon Lott said he, quote, wanted to throw up when he saw the video, which I appreciate this guy's sentiment. This young lady has a cast on her arm. She has neck and back injuries and rug burn on her forehead from being, like, yanked across the floor like an animal. Okay. These are quotes. Janelle George from the NAACP, she's the Legal Defense Fund Education Specialist. She says, it shows the dangers of increases... increased police presence in schools. The push for more officers started after the Columbine school shootings in 1999 with an eye towards student safety, but we are seeing the conflation between safety and discipline, which is exactly what we've been talking about. And also, school shootings have gone up since Columbine.
Yeah.
There's more cops in schools now than ever before, and the numbers are going up, not down. Plus, I would venture to say, probably not incidents this extreme where you're going to catch it on camera and see this stuff, but I'm sure there's people getting fucked by the cop being there more so than people are being saved by the cop being there. You know what I mean? Like, maybe not to this extent, but there's definitely stuff going on where it's discipline over safety, which is not what they're there for. That's
how do you mean by fucked?
Like
the drugs, like that. Yeah, maybe somebody's or something stupid,
right? Or they're smoking a cigarette in the bathroom or something. You know what I mean? It's like the cops are going to be getting involved in situations that could just be handled by like a slap on the wrist, metaphorically, and like detention. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Where now people end up getting going to jail,
chalk-coated and flipped,
right? And also the kid that stood up to defend her, I don't think he like went after the cop, but he was like, what are you doing, like, stop. He should do that. That's the right human response to that situation. And he's now he has he's being criminalized for doing what any human being should do in that circumstance, which is like, whoa, that's insanely over the line. What are you doing?
Mm-hmm.
We got another quote from Leon Lott. This is a longer quote. The Richland County Sheriff. This is his quote. He says, he was wrong, and so was his action. It's not what I expect of my deputies. He picked a student up, and he threw a student across the room. Based on that, that is a violation of our policy. I do not feel the proper procedure was used at that point, and that's what caused me my heartburn and my issues with this. The maneuver that he used was not based on the training or acceptable. Great, and the cop was fired. So this guy put his money where his mouth was, fired the cop. Great. He should be fired. This is Fields' lawyer, and then I'll let you go. Mm-hmm. He says, to that extent, we believe that Mr. Fields' actions were carried out professionally and that he was performing his job duties within the legal threshold. Sure.
Absolutely. You totally have to subdue that threat with a chokehold and a flip.
Well, that girl was being a maniac. I mean, she was sitting there peering at her phone, saying nothing, doing nothing. Just, she's not even out of control. Like, that's
she was a distraction to the classroom.
Yeah. The cop flipping her
was not
a distraction. Putting a Kevin Nash power bomb on her, not a distraction, but okay. So anyway, you got any like little wrap up thoughts about that? Because I got one more thing and then we'll get to the debate.
No, but I have to say, I totally appreciate the Kevin Nash throw out there.
I know you do. Woo! All right. So that's been out there. I figured we'd bring it up. And because it tied in nicely with that email, so I wanted to bring it up. Also, Alejandro, I love you, man. I'm not, you know. Yeah, I'm just using it to be, you know, inform the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Ben Carson overtakes Donald Trump in a New York Times CBS News poll. For the first time, Carson is ahead of Trump 26% to 22%. These are pre-debate polls, obviously. Oh, okay. So, because it's too, you know, the debate was last night, they didn't do polling. But it's interesting because, in my opinion, when Trump, if he stays in second place and he's consistently coming in second place, we're headed down the road where Donald Trump says his goodbye to this whole thing.
I think he sticks around for a little while.
A little while, but if it gets any worse.
I can't see it getting worse. No,
why? Can't you see it getting worse?
Because that debate last night's an example of it.
Well, we're going to talk about the debate right now. Are you ready to get into this thing?
Yes.
So, like I always say, I have my debate notes here. Oh, this font's like a lot smaller on this computer. My God. It'll be fine. So, I have my debate notes. I call them live tweet notes, but they're not really live. I watch them. I write stuff down. I put the time code, and then we go through it. I cut it down a little bit from last time because it felt like it
was. By a little bit, you mean two, right? Like two segments you cut it out?
You know, like 4 minutes, a little shorter. No, because I feel like maybe it drains on a little bit, but like this was a weird debate anyway.
It was very weird.
It's going to be interesting. Now, Joey, well, first of all, Shelby, did you check out the debate? Did you see this thing?
Yes, caught the end of it.
Caught the end of it. Okay, yeah, you got there for the finale. I get it. Evan, you check it out or what? You can just yell. He saw parts of it. All right. So, you know, if you guys see something that you want to, you know, make a comment about, feel free. We got plenty of comments here. Joey.
Yes.
You told, I said, Joey, did you watch the debate? And you're like, yeah, I saw it. And
yeah, I
was like,
I saw it.
Oh, okay. And then you're like, you know, but I watched the Mets a little bit and I thought it started at 9. So I was like, so what'd you watch?
The power went out.
25 minutes. Yeah, the power went out in your house. What the fuck are you talking about? So you watched it for like 20 minutes. No, you watched, what, an hour?
About an hour and a half.
How did, without getting into crazy specifics, and it's kind of a stupid thing, like, who won the debate? But like, did anybody stand out, you know, as a positive for you, particularly out of the front runners?
I do have to say, I feel Rubio was the one who stepped out and said, I am a viable candidate.
Sure. I mean, that's been the before. Now, I also want to say this because it's important. All of my notes are done before I look at anything.
Yes.
I get the video online. I watch it. I take my notes and then I'll go on, you know, news sites
and
like,
see
what
how
people
everyone
are
reacts.
Okay. So understand that this is all done before the other information comes out.
Well, you're just saying that we can't 100% prove
you that. Can't verify it, but I would never lie to you, Samsonites. That's nonsense. That's the media meme.
Yes.
That Rubio, you know, this is like his kind of his coming out party. I don't know. I'm a little bearish on that. Not okay. Like he did fine. I don't think he did anything to disqualify himself. And of course, I have notes about that as we go through.
The whole finance thing did seem a little off, though.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see as we get through it. But he, you know, I think he did fine. And again, compared to some of the other shit, yeah, he looks terrific. Plus, it's turning out that he's winning the Sheldon Adelson, the billionaire casino magnate. He's getting a lot of the money from Sheldon Adelson. So.
Oh,
so
that
he's
helps.
Probably feeling a little confident. In all likelihood, it's going to be Rubio. That's really what I feel, which is interesting why the media now is all of a sudden like, Rubio looked great. Yeah, because he's at least better than Carson and Trump and, you know, Bush. I will say this. I'm surprised by how poorly he did last night. I think he
imploded.
I wouldn't say imploded, but he really did not. I mean, he's just petering out. I mean, he's really not doing well. And he resorted to a tactic that I'm very surprised that he went with. Anyways, let's start this video up and then we can really see what's going on. Let me just get the volume right here and then I'll pause it. Too loud, Joey, or what?
A little loud.
No, I think that's okay.
Then why bother asking?
Great question. All right. They introduced them. Big applause for Rubio and Fiorina. Nice applause for Trump and Carson, but Rubio and Fiorina actually got the big applause, which is interesting.
Where are they?
They're in Colorado or Colorado.
Do any of them have home field advantage? I don't believe so.
No.
Okay.
All right, so here we go. Now, I'll say this. I skipped around like the Cruises and the Huckabees and Rand Paul, even though I like Rand Paul, honestly, like I think he seems like a decent guy and his ideas are, some of them are a little bit out there, but it's like, I can appreciate kind of like the libertarian point of view and he's fine to me, but I skipped around some of the lesser guys, Kasich. Like, aww. I have certain clips here and there, yeah, but they're just not viable and that's what ends up taking up a lot of the time.
Yes, that is true.
Having said that, I wanted to play one of Ted Cruz because his response to what is your biggest weakness is a rough one, and I found it annoying, so I just wanted to play it. Here's Ted Cruz talking about what his biggest weakness is.
Weakness is exactly the opposite. I'm a fighter. I am passionate about what I believe. I've been passionate my whole life about the Constitution. And, you know, for 6.5 years, we've had a gigantic party. If you want someone to grab a beer with, I may not be that guy. But if you want someone to drive you home, I will get the job done, and I will get you home.
Ah. So he's going to DD the country?
Yeah, he's going to. What a weirdo thing to say. It fell flat because usually he's very prepared with his, mm-hmm. like, and I love liberty. You know, he ends strong, and he was just like, you might not want a beer with me, but I'll drive you home. He was like, this is a dumb analogy. He in the middle of saying it, he was like, he realized how bad it was. Stupid one. Yeah, this is a dumb one.
Is he also going to mention that you shouldn't be having the alcohol?
Oh, stop it, Joey. Come on. Trump is questioned about his tax plan. He defends it by saying that Larry Kudlow, who's a CNBC like anchor guy, mm-hmm. loves it. Jeb jumps in and says Trump's plan doesn't work. We don't have to watch that clip. It doesn't matter. I also thought Trump had just he's hitting the one note now. You know, like, he's showing that he can't go any more or less than what he's doing right now. Mm-hmm. It's the same shtick every time, and I have comments about that, obviously, but we'll get into it. Ben Carson is asked how he thinks the flat tax will work. Most of the candidates believe their plans will work, despite the numbers, because the economy will grow. So a lot of times they're asked about their plan, and they're like, you know, the moderators are saying the numbers just don't add up. They're like, well, you're not factoring in the fact that the economy is just going to be amazing.
Yeah, it's going to grow to the exact number we need it to grow for the system to work.
Correct.
Because so, that's the way life is.
Absolutely. Well, yeah, of course. Right. It's a very hopeful, hopeful approach. We're going to play more Carson than we've played in the past because Carson is in the lead. Carson's like really getting a lot of money, mm-hmm. and he's becoming arguably the front runner. So this man Carson is talking about his flat tax plan.
We're coming back to you in a minute. Well, Becky's moving on.
Dr. Carson, let's talk about taxes. You have a flat tax plan of 10% flat taxes, and I've looked at it, and this is something that is very appealing to a lot of voters, but I've had a really tough time.
The flat tax pan is where you cook the books.
Mm, clever.
Nope.
Trying to make the math work on this. If you were to take a 10% tax with the numbers right now on total personal income, you're going to come in with bringing in $1.5 trillion. That is less than half of what we bring in right now. And by the way,
perfect.
It's going to leave us in a $2 trillion hole. So what nice. Analysis got you to the point where you think this will work?
I don't remember this woman's name at all, but I like
it. It was Becky.
Was it Becky?
I thought it was Becky.
I don't know. It doesn't matter. But she was good. Like,
okay.
She didn't get aggressive, but she was like, I don't understand how you arrived there. The CNBC moderators are taking a lot of shit today, I've been reading, because in fairness, they did bring up a lot of not like kind of nonsense stuff, and it was more like interpersonal things. However, I have notes about it later, but I feel like that's sort of, when you have this many people, that's sort of the nature of the thing. How are you going to get into this like really extensive debate?
Yeah, you have 15 people you got to choose between.
Yeah, you got to get specific and ask them something. Plus, well, whatever. We'll get into it later. But anyway, I think she did a nice job, particularly. The other ones, you know, I could take or leave.
Well, first of all, I didn't say that the rate would be 10%. I used the tithing analogy.
I understand that, but if you look at the numbers, you probably have to get to 28%.
The rate is going to be much closer to 15%.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
15% still leaves you with a $1.1 trillion hole.
You also have to get rid of all the deductions and all the loopholes. You also have to do some strategic cutting in several places.
Everything.
Remember, we have 645 federal agencies and sub-agencies. Mm-hmm. Anybody who tells me that we need every penny in every one of those is in a fantasy world. So also, we can stimulate the economy. That's going to be the real growth engine, stimulating the economy, because it's tethered down
you'd
right now
cut,
with so many regulations.
You'd have to cut government by about 40% to make it work with a $1.1 trillion hole.
It's not.
See, I like her very calm approach where she's like, well, factually, you'd have to basically cut government in half, which is impossible because you'd have to cut the military, which you're not going to do, and you'd have to do, you know, X, Y, Z. You're just not going to do it.
Not true.
It's not true. Sorry, I'm stepping over her, and she deserves her spotlight here.
Because it's tethered down
you'd
right now
cut,
with so many
to,
regulations.
You'd have to cut government by about 40% to make it work with a $1.1 trillion hole.
It's not true.
It is true. I looked at the numbers.
When we put all of the facts down, you'll be able to see that it's not true. It works out very well.
Dr. Carson.
All right. Very good, Dr. Carson. Now, this guy, talk about not being ready for prime time. This guy's not ready for prime time. He's, you know, whatever, renowned neurosurgeon, very accomplished.
He's got more debates.
A bore. And the more time he gets, see, this is the double-edged sword of being in the lead, he's going to get more time to answer questions. And when he does answer the questions, you're like, wait a minute, that doesn't make sense.
It doesn't sound right.
It's the same thing as all of his crazy answers where he's talking about, you know,
rushing people.
Come on, everyone. Let's shoot. Like, God damn it, Ben Carson. You just don't make any sense. Kasich goes after Trump and Carson and others for fantasy plans. Now, the reason why I wanted to play this, this is going to give Kasich a little shine. I think it's interesting, I guess, that he does this. But this is also like classic. This is the move that everybody makes during this debate. They all copied each other's playbook where it's like, can we just get to the real issues? Can we stop being silly? You know, they all play this game.
Which, by the way, I just want to point out, anytime they did talk about the real issues, they had fantasy ways of coming out of it.
Absolutely, but that's neither here nor there.
That doesn't help.
Well, we're going to get into it. But believe me, I have notes about this. All right, so this is Kasich just going after Trump and Carson and, you know, other people on stage. Let him say what he's got to say. Oh, shit, what did I do?
About in the beginning.
I'm about to ask you about this. That is, you had some very strong words to say yesterday about what's happening in your party and what you're hearing from the two gentlemen we've just heard from. Would you repeat it?
I'm the only person on this stage that actually was involved in the chief architect of balancing the federal budget. You can't do it with empty promises. You know, these plans would put us trillions and trillions of dollars in debt. I actually have a plan. I'm the only one on this stage that has a plan that would create jobs, cut taxes, balance the budget, and can get it done because I'm realistic. You just don't make promises like this. Why don't we just give a chicken in every pot while we're, you know, coming up with these fantasy tax schemes? We'll just clean it up.
You know, it'd be funny. He should have said clucking up with these, you know, like go with that chicken metaphor. Joey literally rolled his eye. Joey just looked at me with the most hatred I've ever seen.
We're going to clean it up. You have to deal with entitlements. You have to be in a position to control discretionary spending. You got to be creative and imaginative. Now, let me just be clear, John.
Nah, it's okay. So now he gets into his whole plan. It doesn't matter because you're not going to win. All right. So that was Kasich. Now, Trump hits back at Kasich. Kasich responds, but it doesn't matter. Trump hits him pretty good here. But again, this is the one note that Trump is really good at hitting. The rest of the time, it's just like vagaries and saying Mexico and China a bunch of times. All right, so this is Trump hitting back at Kasich, which, you know, whatever. It's funny, I guess.
Fracking, okay? He hit oil. He got lucky with fracking. Believe
me. He's talking about the Ohio economy. I cut off the beginning of that.
Okay.
He's like, he got lucky with oil.
That's why Ohio is doing well. And that's important for you to know. Number two, This is the man that was a managing general partner at Lehman Brothers when it went down the tubes and almost took every one of us with us, including Ben and myself.
Oh, what?
Because I was there and I watched what happened.
Yeah, it's interesting. Trump's like buddy-buddy with Carson quite a bit during this debate.
Yeah, he is. Well, he's just going to be buddy-buddy with who's ever in first place. That's his game plan.
Yeah, well, he's out of his mind, though. I don't think he's really running, but if he is actually running and he thinks that he's going to like somehow get a VP nod or something.
Oh, my God, that'd be...
He's out of his mind.
Ben Carson and Trump?
Brothers started it all. He was on the board, and he was a managing general partner. Okay. And just thirdly, he was so nice. He was such a nice guy. And he said, oh, I'm never going to attack... But then his poll numbers tanked. He's got very, that's why he's on the end. And he got nasty. And he got nasty. So you know what? You can have him. Okay, hey,
Trump is such a dismissive fuck. He really is. I mean, it's funny, but he's such a douche. He's not a douche. That's the thing. Like, that's funny. Like, this guy's funny. He'll say anything. He doesn't care. It's funny. I enjoy it. Anyway, Carson defends his flat tax plan poorly. This is the next clip that I have here. And bear with me while I get to the cue. Wait for it, Joey.
Okay. If you're talking about an $18 trillion economy, you're talking about a 15% tax on your gross domestic product. You're talking about...
$1.8 trillion. Okay. If it's 10%. Oh, he's saying 15, right? Or whatever. Okay.
$2.7 trillion.
Right, 15.
We have a budget closer to $3.5 trillion. Mm-hmm. But if you also apply that same 15% to... several other things, including corporate taxes and including the capital gains taxes, you make that amount up pretty quickly. So that's not by any stretch pie in the sky.
Carson uses the expression pie in the sky and wins me over. That's my actual name. I'm voting for, I now support Ben Carson.
Because he said a pie in the
sky. Pie in the sky. I love dumb expressions like that. That might be the title of the episode if I'm being completely frank with you.
Okay.
Pie in the sky sounds pretty good to me. Here's the thing. Does Carson, Reagan's the big sainted hero on the right. Is Carson that charismatic and exciting to listen to? Like, there's something missing there personality-wise.
He wasn't a movie star.
Nah, he's not inspired, but he's not like this bombastic kind of guy that I think is necessary to win the, you know, the conservative nomination, the Republican nomination. He's just not that guy, I feel like, you know. Even if his plans were making sense and all this stuff, you know, it just doesn't seem like it's there.
Only time will tell.
Well, I think we already know. Carly Fiorina wants to reduce the tax code from 73,000 pages to 3, so, quote, single business owners, farmers, or just a couple can understand. That's uber simplistic and obviously not going to be the case, so that's kind of like dumb thing to put out there. All right. Rubio's first chance to do something comes about 20 minutes into this thing. Mixed reviews, in my opinion. The crowd likes the red meat tossed their way at the end. The media is biased, which becomes a theme throughout this. Jeb jumps in and hits Rubio fucking hard, which is interesting. These two are like good friends. Like, they're really friends. Bush is Rubio's mentor. Rubio turns it around nicely. And then I just wrote as an aside, Jeb just doesn't look good most of the time. He's asked why he's doing so poorly. He doesn't do much there. He plugs his website and that's about it because he needs donations. Now let's listen to Marco Rubio. This is his first chance to do something. It's fine. You know, I wouldn't say it's anything spectacular, but here we go.
We will come around the bend, I promise. This one's for Senator Rubio.
Now, again, bear in mind that this is the guy that people are saying really stood out and, like, won the debate. Mm-hmm. I don't know about that. I mean, fine, if that's what the opinion's going to be, then that is probably going to be the case. Like, the story becomes the reality. But I don't know. Watching the thing, I wasn't like, ooh, Rubio. And even still, I think he... I've been saying for the last few weeks, I think he's going to be the guy that's probably going to get the nomination. Him or Jeb, but Jeb
yeah, but
really
the important thing is,
terrible.
The better he does on the next debate, he gets to be closer to the middle.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And it's all about being in where Ben is right now.
The key is to stay close enough, but not enough. Like, Rubio's in a good spot right now. If he can stay, like, in, like, third, or he can move up to third and, like, kind of stay there, he'll get just enough questions where he can, like, you know, volley back and forth with Trump a little bit, answer a little more questions, but kind of stay out of the way, and then hope that when it gets to Iowa, he gets a lot of votes, and, you know, we'll see what happens. Because Trump will be out after that, or before that, even. All right.
You've been a young man in a hurry ever since you won your first election in your 20s. You've had a big accomplishment in the Senate, an immigration bill providing a path to citizenship that conservatives in your party hate and even you don't support anymore. Now you're skipping more votes than any senator to run for president. Why not slow down, get a few more things done first, or at least finish what you start?
Yeah, that's an interesting...
Meanwhile, now they're going to complain about the questioning. It's like, is that a fucking lob pitch to him? Like, how come you're such a go-getter? Like, shut up. That's not a real question. And they're going to complain that the media, like, give me a break.
Question. That's exactly what the Republican establishment says, too. Why don't you wait in line? Wait for what? This country's running out of time. We can't afford to have another 4 years like the last 8 years. Watching this broadcast tonight are millions of people that are living paycheck to paycheck. They're working as hard as they ever have. Everything costs more, and they haven't had a raise in decades. You have small businesses in America that are struggling. For the first time in 35 years, we have more businesses closing than starting. We have a world that's out of control and has grown dangerous, and a president that is weakening our military and making our foreign policy unstable and unreliable in the eyes of our allies, and our adversaries continue to grow stronger. We have they say there's no bipartisanship in Washington. We have a $19 trillion bipartisan debt. And it continues to grow as we borrow money from from countries that do not like us to pay for government we cannot afford. The time to act is now. The time to turn the page is now. If we don't act now, we are going to be the first generation in American history that leaves our children worse off than ourselves.
So, see, so, all right, he answers it, but you can hear it's a little rehearsed. Like, the cadence is rehearsed.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And you can hear that. That could, of course, give me stuff that he works on, but we'll see. I mean, fine answer. No, it did nothing to hurt himself. I don't think it sounded amazing. Okay.
Question for you. Do you feel that the Twitter comments are taking away from the debate?
Oh, what? That little crawl at the bottom?
Yeah, a little crawl.
I don't even look at them, to be honest. Yeah, I try to ignore them, but yeah, of course they are.
Okay.
It's fucking stupid. Why do we need that? Why do we need that at the bottom?
To remind us that everyone's accessible on Twitter, I guess?
It's mental. Well, the bottom, it's paused right now. It says, I've taken a drink every time the CNBC anchor said, quote, ascending. Like, is that part of it? Like, do we need that? Go on Twitter if you want to see what people think about it. You're watching TV now. Watch TV.
Yeah.
It's stupid. All right, let's finish up with this Rubio clip.
So when the Sun Sentinel says Rubio should resign, not rip us off, when they say Floridian sent you to Washington to do a job, when they say you act like you hate your job, do you?
Yeah, let me say, I read that editorial today with a great amusement. It's actually evidence of the bias that exists in the American media today.
But do you hate your job?
Let me answer your question on the Sun Sentinel editorial today. Back in 2004, one of my predecessors to the Senate by the name of Bob Graham, a Democrat, ran for president, missing over 30% of his votes. I don't recall them calling for his resignation.
Is that the standard?
Later that year, in 2004, John Kerry ran for president, missing close to 60 to 70% of his votes. I don't recall the Sun... In fact, the Sun Sentinel endorsed him. In 2008, Barack Obama missed 60 or 70% of his votes, and the same newspaper endorsed him again. So this is another example of the double standard that exists in this country between the mainstream media and the conservative media.
I do have to say, that sounds like a logical argument.
It is, but you know, there's a reason. Sure, it sounds logical. I mean, I'll let him say that. That's fine. I mean, there's obviously something more to it, right? I mean, he's spinning in a different way. Though those numbers might not even be true, what he's saying about how many votes those people missed and all that stuff. But okay, well, I mean, whatever. It is what it is. Fine. He throws some red meat there. The crowd likes it, obviously.
The crowd loves it.
That's where points come. You know what I mean? Like, that's where he's scoring points. It doesn't have to be substantive, really. It's just like, yeah, I agree, Marco. I have a feeling they're doing it too.
Senator, thank you. John?
Can I bring something up here? Because I'm a constituent of the senator, and I helped him, and I expected that he would do constituent service, which means that he shows up to work. He got endorsed by the Sun Sentinel because he was the...
There you go. Yeah, I knew that was coming, so I wanted to wait. Like, right, he's going to say that they endorse all these liberals. Meanwhile, he was endorsed by them. So it's like, shut the fuck... You know, like, so what is that evidence of? That they're equal? Like, there's no bias then? Come on.
Most talented guy in the field. He's a gifted politician. But Marco, when you signed up for this, this was a 6-year term. And you should be showing up to work. I mean, literally, the Senate, what is it, like a French work week? You get like 3 days where you have to show up? You can campaign or just resign and let someone...
Smart by Jeb throws out a reference to something in Europe, which, you know...
We hate.
Yeah.
Else take the job. There are a lot of people living paycheck to paycheck in Florida as well. They're looking for a senator that will fight for them each and every day.
I get to respond, right?
30 seconds.
30 seconds.
Well, it's interesting. Over the last few weeks, I've listened.
Sure.
It seems that during this whole debate, they're like talking to two different people.
What do you mean?
Well,
who they?
The candidates. It seems like paycheck to paycheck. They keep on saying it, but I don't think it registers to them what that actually means.
Oh, of course not. That's just like obvious political, you know, it's the same thing on the left when you have Hillary being like, you know, or anybody, Bernie said, like working class, middle class, you know, it's those buzzwords like paycheck to paycheck. They're talking to what they perceive as like the right thing to say, when in reality, all the Republicans would have to do is like not be so aggressive on immigration, maybe support weed legalization. They'd get a much broader coalition of people. Mm-hmm. They're fighting over like the poor white people. That's who they're fighting over. That's why they use this kind of coded language. That's why they go so far to the right. If they would just broaden their appeal just a little bit, loosen up a little bit on gay marriage, loosen up on, you know, any of these issues, say, you know what, maybe Black Lives Matter does have a little bit of a point.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. You might be surprised at how much that opens up the dialogue and maybe you can get some more votes. But they are fighting over a narrow sliver of the population. And that's why you hear this language over and over again. This is sad to watch, these two fighting. Mm-hmm. They'll hug it out, though.
...to Jeb as you've walked around the country and said that you're modeling your campaign after John McCain, that you're going to launch a furious comeback the way he did by fighting hard in New Hampshire and places like that, carrying your own bag at the airport. You know how many votes John McCain missed when he was carrying out that furious comeback that you're now modeling it under?
He wasn't my concern.
No, Jeb, I don't remember. Well, let me tell you, I don't remember you ever complaining about John McCain's vote record. The only reason why you're doing it now is because we're running for the same position and someone has convinced you that attacking me is going to help you.
Well, I've been...
Oof. Now, that hurts. That's what I mean. That hit him hard. I also, in my mind, have a little bit of a conspiracy theory. Again, these two are, like, close. They've been friends for a long time. This might be a setup. This might have been, a little alley-oop for Jeb. To Rubio, because Jeb's out of it. It seems like Jeb seems like he's kind of resigned his fate. Like, well, my brother, fuck, you know, it's just not gonna happen. So he loves Rubio. So maybe he's like, here, I'll tell you what, I'll give you a couple softballs that you can crush during the debate, and then, you know, when it comes,
we see where you are next.
When
week.
It comes cuffing season to pick your vice president, you know who your guy is. So that could be. I'm not saying that's the case.
So are you saying that they handcuffed each other already?
What? No, it's cuffing. Forget it, Joe.
Okay.
Here's the bottom line. I'm not... My campaign is going to be about the future of America. It's not going to be about attacking anyone else on this stage. I will continue to have tremendous admiration and respect for Governor Bush. I'm not running against Governor Bush. I'm not running against anyone on the stage. I'm running for president because there is no way we can elect Hillary Clinton to continue the policies of Barack.
Thank you, Senator.
Okay, see, so now, so right, so Rubio turns that around nicely. Jeb lets him do it. Jeb doesn't, like, cut him off at all anymore. It could be. I'm not saying that Jeb's throwing the towel in. I think he still has maybe a frag. You know, I mean, he has as much chance as Carson does, I feel like, right? Like
at this point.
But could have been a little alley-oop to Rubio. Just a thought. Who knows? Let's see. Fiorina is asked to defend her HP record. I'm not going to say. You'll know why I'm playing it. Disappointing performance, I feel like, in this one. She didn't capitalize on the momentum from... Mm-hmm. She didn't do anything since the last debate, I feel like. She didn't capitalize on any of it. And it's the same shit. They keep asking her about HP. So let's hear what Carly Fiorina has to say, and then you'll know exactly when I'm tired of hearing about this.
...for 9 quarters in a row. As an outsider, I tackled HP's entrenched problems head-on. I cut the bureaucracy down to size, reintroduced accountability, focused on service, on innovation.
All right, and we're done. Okay. So there she is with the innovation. A couple of people snapped, sent me snaps being like, she's saying it. She's saying innovation. all right, and then actually I skip ahead a little bit. We do have a little bit more from Carly Fiorina, but that fucking, the way she's in innovation is just mental. Hold on, sorry, my hand's not working. There we go.
Looking for that in Washington now. And yes, I was fired over a disagreement in the boardroom. There are politics in the boardroom as well. And yet the man who led my firing, Tom Perkins, an icon of Silicon Valley, has come out publicly and said, you know what? We were wrong. She was right. She was a great CEO. She'd be a great president of the United States because the leadership she brought to HP is exactly the leadership we need in Washington, D.C.
So she can be fired.
Yeah, once again, I mean, we've gone at length at Carly Fiorina. We read the whole Steve Jobs thing and all that shit where it's like, no, you were a terrible... Stop it. That's not the case. Meanwhile, she brings up this guy, Tom Perkins. They listen to the... Again, this... What is the woman's name? Becky, you said?
I think it's Becky something.
It doesn't matter, but... Well, it does matter probably to her parents, her friends, and family, but I don't know her name, but she did a nice job. Listen to how she comes back real smooth.
Mrs. Fiorina, it's interesting that you bring up Mr. Perkins because he said a lot of very questionable things. Last year in an interview, he said that he thinks wealthy people should get more votes than poor people. I think his quote was that if you pay $0 in taxes, you should get 0 votes. If you pay $1 million, you should get 1 million votes. Is this the type of person you want to defend?
Well, this is one of the reasons why Tom Perkins and I had disagreements in the boardroom, Becky.
Oh, it is Becky.
It is Becky.
All right.
Nevertheless, one of the things that I think people don't always understand is how accountable a CEO actually is. So, you know, I had to report results every 90 days in excruciating detail. I had to answer every single question about every single result and every single projection in public until there were no more questions. And if I misrepresented those results or those projections in any way, I was held criminally liable.
Oh, yeah, because they were going to send you to jail. Stop. CEOs don't go to jail in America. That's not how that works. Like, that's such a bullshit thing. That's why I wanted to play that. Let her wrap up and then we'll move on.
Imagine if a politician were held to that standard of account. I will run
they would
on my
all be in jail.
Yeah, I know, but that's what she's implying. It's like, oh, stop it. No, CEOs are going to jail. Politicians are not really going to jail. Come on.
No one's going to jail.
It's just ridiculous. All right, so I continued here and I made a little comment. I said, Cruz is gaining weight. The campaign trail is rough. He might be hitting up a lot of fast food. He should be careful. He's not a young man anymore. He does. He looks like he put on a couple of pounds, but it's all right.
How many is a couple to you? Like 10?
Maybe a little more. You look. I mean, he's gained a little bit of weight. He's a little fat fatty with a lot of anger problems. That could be a good title, Fat Fatty with Anger Problems.
I like that.
Look at him. He did. He ballooned up a little bit, Joe. You could tell.
He did.
His neck is hanging out over that shirt. Cruz throws some more red meat. At least one person in every debate has to do this move. He keeps going on like an asshole. He's really a clown, and he's embarrassing himself with this. Meanwhile, the questions are basically fucking softballs with no definitive answer. You can say whatever you want to almost everything. Stop whining. Plus, he says the questions for the Democrats were, why are you so handsome and wise? Which is obviously nonsense. We played clips, and most of them are legitimate politics. We watched that debate. I mean, we got into it in detail.
Yes.
Were a lot of the questions like, why are you so good at your job? Like, that's not what the questions were. They were like, how do you, you know, Syria, and what would you do with a, you know, a, no fly zone, and all this stuff. They got into like a lot of stuff. It was legitimate. They talked about taxes. They talked about a lot of stuff. Christie is a surprising non-factor. I have a Cruz clip we're going to play, but Christie is a surprising non-factor. He always attacks Hillary, which is kind of a smart move, except he's made no traction against anyone on the stage. It's fine that he's looking ahead and trying to keep it in everybody's mind that he would go up against Hillary Clinton. Smart.
Mm-hmm.
But he's not doing well against anybody here. He's just kind of a non-factor. I will say this. This was probably his most engaged
Best
debate
showing.
Towards the end. Yeah, but it's nothing crazy. Cruz showed up like a clown. Moderator says, we're clearly not having... Oh, well, whatever. Maybe I don't even know if I play that clip. Well, I'll read it. The moderator says, we're clearly not having a beer, like he mentioned earlier. Like, I might not be the guy you'll have a beer with. Cruz says he'll get him a tequila or a, quote, famous Colorado brownie. Come out in support of weed legalization then, dum-dum. If you're going to make that joke about the pot brownies,
you can let
just
them have it.
Go for it. Like, you're going to win.
Can I say them? Say it? Let them have the brownie.
Let them eat brownie.
Yeah, let them eat brownie.
That could be a good title, too.
Okay.
Let me say something at the outset. The questions that have been asked so far in this debate illustrate why the American people don't trust the media.
He's such a butthole. This guy, like, he runs on applause, Cruz. Like, that's what he lives
well,
for.
But too, also, that we have a habit of doing it, they are playing to a crowd.
Yes. Yeah, but there's an art to that. Like, Trump is playing to a crowd, too, but he knows when to do it.
He's always playing to the crowd. He's playing to everybody.
Yeah, yeah, of course. But Cruz
is playing to a certain segment of people.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
And,
sure. Yeah, absolutely. But it's red meat. It's always, all right, finish up, Ted.
This is not a cage match. And you look at the questions. Donald Trump, are you a comic book villain? Ben Carson, can you do math? John Kasich, will you insult two people over here? Marco Rubio, why don't you resign? Jeb Bush, why have your numbers fallen? How about talking about the substantive issues people care about?
Oh, they all do this tonight.
It's the same thing. They all do it. They all aped this move. And also, in fairness, Bernie Sanders did this move as well.
With
the Hillary. We're tired of the goddamn emails. Or whatever, whatever he said. I don't think he said goddamn, but that's a move.
Yes.
And they're all doing it.
Does this count? Do we get credit for this one?
And Carl, I'm not finished yet. The contrast with the Democratic debate, where every fawning question from the media was, which of you is more handsome and wise?
Is that really true? No, that's a pretend thing that he said. We watched that debate. It was, okay.
So this is
and
a
let
question
me be
about
clear.
The debt limit, which you have 30 seconds left to answer, should you choose to do so.
Let me be clear.
I was praying at that moment.
Here, we drink some water.
Well, not that he would drink some water, that it would get worse. You know, like when you get a tickle in your throat, and you're like, I can't, I can't talk. I was like, please God, let it happen. But it just didn't. He got through it.
The men and women on this stage have more ideas, more experience, more common sense than every participant in the Democratic debate.
It's simply not
true.
All the candidates on the Democratic debate have been elected officials. Hillary Clinton was the Secretary of State. Bernie Sanders has been a senator for 40 years. Lincoln Chafee was a governor. He was in Congress. I forget what his position was. Webb's been a senator. Like, that's just simply not true. They have more experience, really, if you average it out. Carson, zero experience. Trump, zero experience. Like, what are you doing?
He's just talking.
Yeah,
let
he just
talk.
Says whatever he wants and people enjoy it. Yeah.
That debate reflected a debate between the Bolsheviks and the Mensheviks.
Good one. Well, he's got his clown shoes on.
I don't get it.
And nobody watching at home believes that any of the moderators has any intention of voting in a Republican primary.
Sorry.
The questions that are being asked shouldn't be trying to get people to tear into each other. It should be, what are your substantive solutions to people who are hurting?
I just want the record to reflect. I asked you about the debt limit, and I got no answer.
You want to answer that question? I'm happy to answer the question. Let me tell you how the question is. Let me tell you how
that
question
is.
I've got a question for you.
So you don't actually want to hear the answer, John?
No.
You don't want to hear the answer. You just want to listen to the insult.
You used your time on something else. Senator Paul?
You're not interested in an answer,
John. Senator Paul.
Oof! Shut him down. Good. It's like shut the fuck. You know, you went on your soapbox. That was your time. You used your time.
You blew it.
You're nowhere. Okay. Trump is asked about bankruptcy again. It's hard to say whether this is hurting him or what. It keeps coming up every debate. He gives the same answer every time. Where it's like, I use the proper business tools. You know, and he just goes into
doesn't
the
that
spiel.
Scale anyone though? that he used the procedure correctly to his benefit.
Right. Well,
hey, this system is set up in such a way that someone can actually make out better than they were doing.
Yeah, he could just cut bait and run. Right, the people that work at the casinos and whatever that lose their jobs doesn't matter.
No,
Trump worked
shit.
Out fine. I use the, you know, he says the same thing all the time. All right, we don't have to get into it, but I'm just pointing it out. I don't know whether that's hurting him or not, the bankruptcy thing, but it does come up a lot. Then I wrote, oh fuck, they brought out Jim Cramer. Great, let's yell some. Damn it, I stepped on my own. Okay, Carson
can't have it back.
No, he's the mad money guy. He's a psycho. Carson is having an okay debate. He's very even keel. I don't see how anyone would be impressed or dismayed by him so far, like I've been saying. It's like, he is what he is. Christie is asked if General Motors higher-ups should have been prosecuted for their manufacturing cover-up. He says the DOJ is political, and then he mentions someone, and we're going to play that for that reason.
Nice.
So we're skipping ahead quite a bit here. Yeah, that's about right.
Play my boy.
The fact is that this.
Yeah, I know, and that's why that's always in my head. I'm like, God, dummy. Can you show me the overweight governor in New Jersey, please?
Justice Department under this president has been a political justice department. It's been a justice department that's decided that they want to pick who the winners and losers are. They like General Motors, so they give them a pass. They don't like somebody else, like David Petraeus. They prosecute them and send a decorated general to disgrace.
It's points.
It's not points, and the reason why I wanted to play that clip, we talked about this on the podcast. Petraeus leaked classified information to his biographer, who he's also fucking at the time.
Yeah, pillow talk.
By the way, pretty sure we covered that on the program. We did. But yeah, it's political. He got a $100,000 fine and 2 years probation. He fucking leaked classified documents.
But
he
was disgraced.
They all want to hang Snowden. He's not disgraced. Petraeus will be back. He'll write a book, What I Learned. You know, it's just annoying that that's the example he chooses to bring up. Meanwhile, if he hates Snowden, I'm sure. I mean, the blowhard, I'm sure, is way against Snowden.
What do you think the title of the book would be?
Petraeus' book?
Yes. Things Not to Talk About in Sex?
Yeah, In and Out and Back Again.
Nice.
What I Learned About Pillow Talk, Classified Documents, and America's Liberty.
I just like
write that down.
Again.
Let's can we copyright that? Christie says he'll make justice, quote, more than just a word. It'll be a way of life. Then he spit-shined his sheriff's badge and headed off to Applebee's for some half-price apps.
that's what
I read for that. Okay, didn't go over. 46 minutes, 11 seconds. Shelby, you thought that was funny, right?
Yeah.
No, so let the people know.
Hilarious.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Bush ends his campaign right here,
right now. Play it.
What the fuck? Is W actually a better politician?
Yes.
Look, the deal was already done. The biggest tax increase happened under the watch of Barack Obama, and spending's gone up. You find a Democrat that's for cutting taxes, cutting spending $10, I'll give him a warm kiss.
Thank you, Governor.
Oh, what the fuck are you talking about? What is that?
I don't know.
That's desperation. That is as uncomfortable as it gets. He's just completely lost. Ugh. I mean, well, whatever. Listen, there's nothing hotter than two really attractive guys really making out. But I'm just saying, it's weird when Jeb Bush does it. A warm kiss. What a weird thing to say.
Shouldn't it have been a hot kiss?
Anything, Shelby?
You could have told me, like, I'm going to play you an audio clip. Do not react at all to it or we'll shoot you. And then you play that and I would instinctively go, what?
Yeah, which you actually did. Yeah, you were off mic and he was just like, what? Like, why the fuck would you even consider putting the words, first of all, warm kiss.
Warm kiss.
Yeah, oh, what a freaking weird move that was.
Is he hinting that he wants a piece of Hillary?
I have no idea what he was talking about there. That's that made me uncomfortable when I heard it. It's just like, warm kiss. What a horrible move. And that to me, it's like, whatever, he's done. Like, nobody's going to respond well to that. It's not even funny. Like, he's trying to be funny, but he's just so off kilter. He doesn't know what the hell's going on. Rubio deflects questions about his fiscal intelligence, brings the heat with a classic line. The moderator stays at him. He handles it. He's not spectacular.
Was it something about his dad?
He's adequate. Don't blow it.
Okay.
You know what's weird, Joey?
Yes.
This is in my notes, but I'm asking you now as though I'm thinking of it right now. They're all acting like the CNBC people are probably Democrats, but it would seem to me that the business people and money market people are either conservative or agnostic politically, because that's the easiest way to make, like, don't be aligned with either party. Go with the party that's going to make you the most money at the right time.
Absolutely.
Like, it doesn't seem to me like these people are really political or like lefties.
No, I believe the thing was marketing. Watch your, it's your money for your vote, or vote for your money, or
exactly.
something.
Exactly, it's all about. It's supposed to be all be about money and tax plans and stuff like that. But right, but to couch these people as like leftist, like come on, Rick Sant. He comes on later. I guess his name is Rick Santelli or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. He was the guy whose bullshit comments on the stock market sparked Occupy Wall Street. Like, he's such an asshole.
Oh.
Remember, I mean, this is a long time ago. Yeah, going back. You can find the clip. But, like, they're conservative, I'm pretty sure. Or, like I said, politically agnostic. All right. This is Rubio deflecting some questions, throws out a little red meat. And then I wrote, also, I skipped through Cruz and Huckabee and Rand Paul, even though I find him to be a decent guy with some ideas I can wrap my head around, because they're not going to be factors here.
No.
They treat Rand Paul like a bitch on the end of the,
you know. He's just there.
Even though he has actual ideas. You might not agree with them. I might not agree with all of them. But he actually has an ideology. It's like a legitimate, okay.
Senator Rubio, you yourself have said that you've had issues. You have a lack of bookkeeping skills. You accidentally intermingled campaign money with your personal money. You face foreclosure on a
What's with Becky Quick's voice, though? I was wondering that. She does a little bit of the vocal fry at the end. I can't really do it, but, you know, she asks
questions. Let her play it. Like Let her play.
What, do you think she smokes a lot of cigs or what? She's got a little vape
I didn't
pen.
Even notice it, so play it.
Oh, we'll try to notice it.
Now, I'm going
to
try now.
All right. She's like a film noir vixen, her voice.
Second home that you bought, and just last year you liquidated a $68,000 retirement fund.
$1,000. You don't hear that?
I think it's fine.
I'm not complaining. I'm just saying, what happened?
A few cigarettes before the
show. It's probably a few cigarettes, or maybe she's just screaming into the mirror. I hate the Republicans! And then she goes out and asks them really libelous questions. All right, here we go. Marco Rubio, what's up, bro?
And that's something that cost you thousands of dollars in taxes and penalties. In terms of all of that, it raises the question whether you have the maturity and the wisdom to leave a $17 trillion economy. What do you say?
Well, you just listed a litany of discredited attacks from Democrats and my political opponents, and I'm not going to waste 60 seconds detailing them all, but I'm going to tell you the truth.
That's the right way to handle that. Don't defend yourself against that. Just be like, that's bullshit. Whether it's bullshit or not, I don't know. And I'll be honest with you, I didn't look it up. Because again, the devil's not in the details here. Mm-hmm. It's like how he handles it. Because people are not, if you're inclined to watch this and vote for them, you don't care about the details of that.
No.
And if you're watching it because you want to criticize them and you're going to vote for Hillary or Bernie Sanders, you assume the details are correct. You know what I mean? So it doesn't even really matter at that point. It's how he handles it. Now, I'm willing to bet there's probably some fire there where there's a little smoke. You know what I mean? Okay.
Here's the truth. I didn't inherit any money. My dad was a bartender. My mother was a maid.
There he is.
I knew that was coming.
Brings the classic line, and I got a Snapchat about that too, where it's like, what? I think he, is his dad a bartender? I forget what the snap. It's like, I don't know. I think I've heard that before, but.
It's hard to provide us the chance at a better life. They didn't save enough money for us to go to school. I had to work my way through school. I had to borrow money to go to school. Try early in my
life. Like every goddamn human being in America.
Mm-hmm.
Explaining to my wife why someone named Sally Mae was taking $1,000 out of our bank account every month.
That was clever.
It's clever. This is a better answer, but then it keeps going. See, the problem with these guys is they don't know how to fucking close it out. Trump closes it out. He's like, nope, we're done. You know, that's blah, blah, blah. And then it's over. These guys let it linger a little bit so they get hit with more questions. It's not solid.
You know what it's like to owe that money, and we've worked hard. We've worked hard our whole life to provide a better life for our family. We own a home 4 blocks away from the place that I grew up in. My 4 children have been able to receive a good Christian education, and I've been able to save for them to go to college.
Well, thank God.
So they never have to have the loans that I did. But I'm not worried about my finances. I'm worried about the finances of everyday Americans who today are struggling in an economy that is not producing good paying jobs while everything else costs more. And that's what this economy needs to be. That's what this debate needs to be about. This debate needs to be about the men and women across this country that are struggling on a daily basis to provide for their families the better future that we've always said this country's all about.
Senator, I understand all of that. I had a lot of student loans when I got out too, but.
And then, you know, also because I would buy cartons of Virginia Slims and a smoke them nonstop, wake up, have a cigarette, go to sleep.
How could you lose?
I love Becky Quick. She's my favorite.
Sponsor.
Chesterfield cigarettes. Well, Joe, remember, we had a little bit of a falling out with Chesterfield cigarettes because it turns out that they do damage to your internal organs, brain, heart, everything, you know.
All right, fine.
But yes, Chesterfield cigarettes. King size or regular, just like the, I can't remember those women, the Corbett sisters or whatever the fuck they were. All right.
The twins.
You've had a windfall that a lot of Americans haven't. You made over $1 million on a book deal, and some of these problems came after.
And I use it to pay off my loans, and it's available on paperback if you're interested in buying it. Well.
Solid. All right. Rubio, hi-oh.
That you liquidated that retirement account after. after the fact. And that cost you about $24,000 out of that in taxes.
So this is a little annoying. I feel like where she's going with this. It was like when Anderson Cooper, after the goddamn emails thing, then he kept going with it. It's like, all right, well, you made your point. We get it. He doesn't understand how taxes work, and he's a little flippant about losing 24 grand because what the fuck does he care? He knows he's going to be a million. Like, he's set now, so it doesn't really matter. I get it. I get what you're doing, but just drop it. Because if you're trying to hurt him, you did, but now you're going to what is that phrase? It's diminishing return. I can't think of what it is, but it's like now you're going at it so much that it's actually coming back the other way where it's like, all right, leave the guy alone.
Yeah, it's not helping.
Fees. That was after you'd already come into that windfall. That's why I raised the question.
Yeah, again, as I said, we're raising a family in the 21st century, and it's one of the reasons why my tax plan is a pro-family.
It's easier to raise a family in the 21st century than the 19th century when it's 2015. Like, you'd have to go back in time and do all the shit. It's a real pain in the ass.
I don't think that's what he means.
That is, I believe that's what he's talking about.
Oh, okay.
Were you going to say something else, or is that it?
No, just play it.
All right.
Tax plan. It increases the per child tax credit. Because I didn't read about this in a book, I know for a fact how difficult it is to raise children, how expensive it's become for working families, and I make a lot more than the average American. Imagine how hard it is for these people out there that are making $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 a year, and they're trying to provide for their families at a time when this economy is not growing. We can't afford another 4 years of that, which is what we're going to get if we elect a big government liberal like Hillary Clinton to the White House.
All right. I mean, again, not spectacular, but it is what it is. He handles it. We have like 6-7 clips left. That's it. So not bad. I mean, I feel like this is a more reasonable amount. I think we're still getting what we need to get out of this thing, and I think it's good. I just said that a lot like Trump, where it's like, listen, boom, bang, boom. I wrote down my notes, and then I think it's great. It's wonderful.
It'll be good.
My Trump is like very spotty. It's sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad. Carson talks about being against gay marriage, but pro-gay people, I guess. Also, Carson apparently has some issue with a company that, I'll be honest, I know nothing about. I'm sure something will come out about it soon, though, after this, which I'm going to play that clip in a second. Trump and Rubio attack the mainstream media. This is like the thing they're doing today.
Yeah, you're just doing it.
Trump says super PACs are bad. Rubio flips it and says Hillary's super PAC is the mainstream media. Ooh.
That was good. That was
good. Cites the Benghazi hearings. And then I wrote the top 1% controls $55 trillion, and then I just didn't finish writing that. But the top 1% controls $55 trillion globally. I don't know what I was gonna do there, but whatever.
It's a lot of money.
We'll just put it out there. 55.49. This is the Carson clip. Whatever. It's a little ahead of it. All right.
About your involvement on some corporate boards, including Costco's.
I'm playing this because this might be he doesn't handle this well, and this is going to be the problem for him, because a lot of people they're going to complain about a media bias. Meanwhile, most of what you hear about Carson in the media is that renowned neurosurgeon, Johns Hopkins, very professional, very intelligent guy. There's not a lot about him that people are going back and being like, he fucked up here, because I actually did a little research. I was reading one of the, and I'm not blaming him, but I'm just putting this out there. It's not something you hear. The first one where he tried to separate the twins with their brains connected, they died.
Oh.
Now, fine, they understood the risk. I'm not saying he like forced them to go do this. And he said, you know, they preferred death than living the way they were living, which is interesting because that argument doesn't work with when women get raped and they want to have an abortion, right?
Yeah.
Okay, but whatever. I'm just saying. So there's not a lot out there about Carson's bad business dealings and different things that he might have fucked. He might have been sued, done different stuff. But it's going to come out, and this is how he handles it, and I don't think he handles it particularly well. But to say that there's a bias, sure, there's a bias all over the place. He gets pretty much good respect from the media.
Marketing study called The Warehouse Retailer the number one gay-friendly brand in America.
Costco.
Partly because of its domestic partner benefits. Why would you serve on a company whose policies seem to run counter to your views on homosexuality?
Well, obviously you don't understand my views on homosexuality. I believe that our Constitution protects everybody, regardless of their sexual orientation or any other aspect. I also believe that marriage is between one man and one woman, and that there is no reason that you can't be perfectly fair to the gay community. They shouldn't automatically assume that because you believe that marriage is between one man and one woman, that you are a homophobe. And this is one of the myths that the left perpetrates on our society.
Yeah.
And this is how they frighten people and get people to shut up. You know, that's what the PC culture is all about. And
the PC culture is not about like telling people who don't like gays and gay marriage to shut up. That's not what PC culture is. And we've talked about instances of PC culture on this where it's like, yeah, we disagree with that. But it's kind of a weird way to go with this, I feel like.
It is.
And also, part of his views on gay people is that it's a choice because look how many people have gay sex in prison and they're not gay in like real life. So obviously being gay is a choice.
That's did he say that?
That is a thing, yes.
That
Why
is
don't
a
you
thing.
Google it, but I guarantee you that's... We can get a quote about that. Just, yeah. That's real. Continue, Ben Carson, while Joey does a little research here. Evan, why don't you try to find it too? Because Joey's not going to be able to find it, I bet.
Destroying this nation.
What are you finding, you son of a bitch? Can you believe this? Ben Carson talking about how being gay is a choice because people in prison choose to have gay sex.
The fact of the matter is, we the American people are not each other's enemies. It's those people who are trying to divide us who are the enemies, and we need to make that very clear to everybody.
One more question. This is a company called Manatech, a maker of nutritional supplements with which you had a 10-year relationship. They offered claims that they could cure autism, cancer. They paid $7 million to settle a deceptive marketing lawsuit in Texas, and yet your involvement continued. Why?
Well, that's easy to answer. I didn't have an involvement with them. That is total propaganda. And this is what happens in our society, total propaganda. I did a couple of speeches for them. I did speeches for other people. They were paid speeches.
All right, let him finish them.
It is absolutely absurd to say that I had any kind of a relationship with them. Do I take the product? Yes. I think it's a good product.
To be fair, you were on the homepage of their website with the logo over your shoulder.
So I have no involvement with them. You're on the website with the logo behind you.
Somebody put me on their homepage. They did it without my permission.
Yeah, of course. Yes, like, clever. Come on.
Yeah.
See, but this is what I'm saying. Like, shit's going to come out. Like, you know that's not true. You know he has involved. I take it. I did some paid speaking gigs. I'm not involved with them, but I'm involved with them.
Money.
They paid me to, literally paid me to be involved with them, but I'm not involved with them.
Does that not speak to your vetting process or judgment in any way?
No, it speaks to the fact that I don't know that it's going
on. Oh, boo. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's out of bounds.
See, they know.
They know.
Yeah. Yeah, see, he's like a goofball.
Play to the crowd.
Yeah.
We're gonna take a break. We'll be back.
Meanwhile, whatever. Good.
You want the quote?
Yeah.
Because a lot of people who go into prison go into prison straight, and then when they come out, they're gay. So did something happen while they were in there? Ask yourself that question.
There you go. And so, okay, so was I lying or is that exactly
that's pretty much
what he said?
I'm shocked.
Don't be shocked. That's the type of crazy shit that you're going to get. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, I lied. Okay, we have like 6 now, but that's fine. Rubio is asked about his tax plan. Then I say, by the way, none of these people and probably nobody on the left is writing their own tax plan. Like, let's be realistic. You know, like they might be involved a little bit, but they have people that are coming up with a pretty normal tax, you know.
I have an idea.
You have an idea? Go ahead.
Can we take a Republican and a Democrat and an economist, put them all together in the same room and try to have them come out with a tax plan?
The problem is that the economist is going to be biased.
Oh.
That's always the thing. Like an economist, because you read about their tax plans today, economists looked through it, scored it, did all this stuff, and it says it's all impossible. You can't do any of it. But they'll go, well, they're biased. They're not including this. So there's no facts actually happening there.
Okay.
It's like, you know, they say it's a real plan, so it is. And in the case of the Trump plan, where he says it's a huge tax break for the middle class. See, that was a solid Trump. And you did the research on that. It's not.
It's not.
It's not. It's no. It's basically the same as everybody. You know, like, they can just say whatever they want about their plans. Now, I wanted to play this again because I think Rubio is getting some shine here, and he is, you know, potentially looking pretty good as things go forward. So this is Rubio talking about his tax plan, and we'll see what he has to say about it.
Sanders and others, they've tried it their way, and it has failed miserably.
Jeb, come on,
we need to take a new approach of taxing, reforming how we tax, and reforming the regulations in our country before it's too late.
Jeb.
Senator Rubio, 30 seconds to you.
You know,
the
honestly,
Tax Foundation, which was alluded to earlier, scored your tax plan.
What the hell? Do you see this, Joey? How's this happening? How are the notes showing up in... Unbelievable. I'm looking, I play all this stuff through VLC Media Player and it's showing my time code there. I did fuck up at one point last night. I guess I can write notes on the video? That's interesting. Well, that's something to look forward to in the future. All right. Rubio
concluded that you give nearly twice as much of a gain in after-tax income to the top 1% as to people in the middle of the income scale. Since you're the champion of
Americans living paycheck to paycheck. Don't you have that backward?
No, you're wrong. In fact, the largest after-tax gains is for the people at the lower end of the tax spectrum under my plan. And there's a bunch of things my tax plan does to help them. Number one, you have people in this country.
Tax Foundation, just to be clear, they said gains after-tax income.
You wrote a story on it. You had to go back and correct it.
No, I did not.
Oh, you did.
No.
And so, because
Senator, the Tax Foundation said after-tax income for the top 1% under your plan would go up 27.9%.
Well, you're talking about
people in the middle of the income spectrum, about 15%.
Yeah, but because the math is, 5% of a million is a lot more than 5% of 1,000. So yes, if someone makes more money, numerically it's going to be higher. But the greatest gains percentage-wise for people are going to be at the lower end of our plan. And here's why. Because in addition to a general personal exemption, we are increasing the per-child tax credit for working families. We are lowering taxes on small business. You know, a lot of business activity in America is conducted like the guy that does my dry cleaning. He's an S corporation. He pays on his personal rate, and he is paying higher than the big dry cleaning chain down the street because he's paying at his personal rate.
In this fantasy world where there's a little mom and pop dry cleaner and then a Kmart dry cleaner? I don't even know. Okay.
Under my plan, no business, big or small, will pay more than 25% flat rate on their business income. That is a dramatic tax decrease for hardworking people who run their own businesses.
John, I'd like to address
the other point that I would make about our plan. One more point. It is the most pro-growth tax plan that I can imagine because it doesn't tax investments at all. You know why? The more you tax something, the less of it you get. I want America to be the best place in the world for people.
Question. Someone living paycheck to paycheck, do they have money for investments?
No, of course not.
So I'm confused.
Right. The investment is pay the car loan. I can go to work and keep making more money to pay the car loan. Anything goes even remotely wrong, I'm screwed. And then you got to go to Money Mutual with Montel Williams or whatever. By the way, I already said that. Trump is stuck answering a ton of questions about illegal immigration. It's getting old, probably, for people that are even supporting him. It's got to be old listening to that, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, all right. Now, Trump clip. I think this is my last Trump clip. Oh, no. I have his closing statement. He also... All right. Trump is asked about guns and whether he'd like his employees to bring guns to work. He says gun-free zones are, quote, a catastrophe. Also, who cares about this? The questions are not asked to, trick the candidates. They're asked because the average Republican primary voter wants to know how the candidates, quote, feel about shit. It's interesting. That's a big criticism of the left, that they're touchy-feely, tree-huggers, etc. A lot of the GOP debates focus on feeling bad for little babies who loves America more. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? It's based on a lot of that emotional stuff. And then they complain when they don't get substantive questions, but nobody wants to do that. They don't want to answer those questions for the most part. They get lost in the weeds, or they just say it's for whatever. You get my point.
Yeah. If it's not about the baby, we don't want to hear it.
Exactly. You know what? I'm not even going to play that Trump clip. You get it. It's fine. They asked him about whether his employees should have guns, and he's like, sure, I'm okay with that. All right. Jeb is asked about whether fantasy sports should be considered gambling or not, brags about his fantasy football team. Christie jumps in like he always does.
Please play the clip.
Took about an hour and 29 minutes to get to a question about climate change, but let's play. All right, let's play that clip. I'm only playing it for you. I hope you know that.
Thank you. And fantasy football.
Well, it's okay. Let me get to, all right, whatever. We'll listen to 5 extra seconds of him yammering.
They can't regulate themselves. Then the NFL needs to look at this, moving away from them a little bit, and there should be some regulation. I have no clue whether the federal government's the proper place. My instinct is to say hell no, just about everything about the federal government.
But can hold on a second. I need to interject.
Are we really talking about getting
we have
government,
a government
involved in fantasy football? We have $19 trillion in debt. We have people out of work. We have ISIS and Al-Qaeda attacking us. And we're talking about fantasy football? Can we stop?
Can we stop?
The answer is absolutely. We should tax fantasy football to the hilt so I don't have to see DraftKings commercials anymore. And we can fix this country off of gambling.
We've done some work with DraftKings at this studio, so I'd appreciate if you'd apologize to DraftKings and explain why they're a great service.
I totally apologize, DraftKings. You're the best service on there, and what is the famous saying? I rescind all my previous comments.
Okay, see, I was lying to you. We actually did work with FanDuel. Listen, Joe, you don't know what the hell's going on.
I'm sorry.
Anyway, Christie comes in. He does his... that's the same shit that they're all trying to do tonight. Cruz did it. Yes. But Christie does it. Whatever. This is where he came alive. He waited an hour and a half into this thing.
Because it had to do with fantasy football.
Well, I don't know what the hell his problem was. Is that about it with that clip? Let's see what this guy's
saying. So you're answering seriously. government to do what they're supposed to be doing. Secure our borders, protect our people, and support American values and American families. Enough on fantasy football. Let people play. Who cares?
Sharon, I want to go.
I wish he had that attitude about smoking weed. Like, let people smoke it. Who cares? No, he's gonna fucking get riled up about that. Christie talks about climate change. He gets snippy. He's very... I want to put this in the right way. It's like, for a guy who's this tough-talking, kind of like big-mouth dude, he's a little like effeminate sometimes in the way he says certain words. And I don't know how to even qualify that. That could just be something that I'm saying. Well, let's see when he gets like snippy here. You'll see what I'm saying. Says he's for an all of the above energy plan, which is what Obama says is his plan, basically. Also, notice the drop in gas prices. That has to do with increase, even though I'm not necessarily a big fan of fracking. That's because of, you know, tapping into natural gas and things like this. Under Obama, right? Gas prices are going, okay, that's a direct correlation. No, I guess that has nothing to do with it. Now Christie pretends that that's not the case and then says he's going to do exactly what we're already doing.
Governor
Christie, you've said something that many in your party do not believe, which is that climate change is undeniable, that human activity contributes to it. And you said, quote, the question is, what do we do to deal with it? So what do we do?
Well, first off, what we don't do is do what Hillary Clinton and John Kerry and Barack Obama want us to do, which is their solution for everything. Put more taxes on it, give more money to Washington, D.C., and then they'll fix it.
That doesn't make sense, but all right.
There's no evidence that they can fix anything in Washington, D.C.
What should we do?
What we should do is to be investing in all types of energy, John. All types of energy. And I've laid out...
Being government?
No, John. John, do you want me to answer? You want to answer.
See what I mean? Like that little snippy, like, John, do you want me to answer? But like, it's like, I don't know. It's just not, I don't know. He's not super masculine for a guy that's like, I don't know, whatever.
I think you're nitpicking.
Yeah, I probably am, sure. And there's a lot to pick.
because I got to tell you the truth, even in New Jersey, what you're doing is called rude. So,
I'm from New Jersey and I don't find anything wrong with it.
We've laid out a national energy plan that says that we should invest in all types of energy. I'll tell you, you could win a bet at a bar tonight since we're talking about fantasy football. If you ask who the top three states in America are that produce solar energy, California and Arizona are easy, but number three is New Jersey. Why? Because we worked with the private sector to make solar energy affordable and available to businesses and individuals in our state. We need to make sure that we do everything we can across all kinds of energy, natural gas, oil, absolutely, but also where it's affordable, solar, wind in Iowa has become very affordable and it makes sense. That's the way we deal with global warming, climate change, or any of those problems, not through government intervention, not through government taxes, and for God's sake, don't send Washington another dime until they stop wasting the money they're already sending there.
Thank you, Governor.
All right, he stumbled a little bit on the end there, but that's fine. I mean, that's simultaneously why people like him and why he's gaining no support, because he's talking about wind and solar and climate change. He's the only one that they can really ask about that.
Yeah, because none of them.
I mean, I guess they could ask Rand Paul. I'm not really entirely sure what Rand Paul thinks about it, but anyway, Trump says a bunch of buzzwords as far as what his economic policy is. The shtick is wearing thin, right? There's no way even the base of the Republican Party is into this anymore. Meanwhile, they just let him answer. Nobody cares about specifics. So I'm going to play this because this could be like one of the last times we hear old Trumpy talk about this stuff. I think he'll probably
don't say that.
We'll see.
Mr. Trump says that he is capable of growing the economy so much that Social Security and Medicare don't have to be touched. Do you want to explain how that's going to happen, Mr. Trump?
Magic. Yes, it's very simple. We're going to make a really dynamic economy.
We're just going to make a really dynamic economy. Great.
So magic.
What we have right now, which is not at all dynamic. We're going to bring jobs back from Japan. We're going to bring jobs back from China.
How?
We're going to bring, frankly, jobs back.
No, do not ask him how.
Okay.
He's on a roll.
You
don't interrupt the guy when he's on a roll. You don't say, what do you mean by dynamic? Why are the jobs in Japan? No.
From Mexico, where, as you probably saw, Nabisco is leaving Chicago with one of their biggest plants, and they're moving it to Mexico. We're going to bring jobs and
You know what? There's a Nabisco plant on one of the... I'm not going to say exactly where it is. When I drive from where my parents live to my girlfriend's, where her parents live when we're home, whatever, beautiful Nabisco plant there. You smell the cookies being made. Great. It's in America.
Do you think he actually has a plan and he's just worried if he tells anybody the plan, that plan would be stolen?
This guy doesn't have a plan, Joey.
Okay.
You know he doesn't have a plan. He's just saying words, but that's what I mean. He's using buzzwords and it's worked so far, but it's got to be wearing thin. I mean, it's just crazy.
Manufacturing back. We're going to cut costs. We're going to save Social Security and we're going to save Medicare.
Governor, you just heard him.
All right. Then they just move on. How? That's it. They just move on from him. I don't know.
Okay.
Carson talks about his idea to replace Medicare. Now, this is not probably this. I don't know. This is not a good move probably to talk about it just politically speaking. Mm-hmm. It's fine. I don't have a problem with having a conversation even about that. Throw out ideas. That's totally okay. But this is going to be another thing where Carson's we'll see what happens.
Replace Medicare with a system of individual family savings accounts so that families could cover their own expenses.
Now, what's going to happen there? First of all, he talks about how people can opt out of that, which mm-hmm. a lot of people are just going to be like, wait, how much money did they just put there? Like 12 grand? Oh, I need that.
Yeah, I need that now.
So they're going to take it. And then what happens when they get sick? They're going to go to the emergency room. They don't have insurance. And then, you know, tax money is going to pay for it anyway, which is what Medicare is for. But okay.
Obviously, that would be a very controversial idea. Explain how that would work exactly.
Well, first of all, the plan gives people the option of opting out, but I think they will see a very good option here. You know, the annual Medicare budget is over $600 billion, and there are 48 million people involved, 40 million, 65 and over, and 8 million other. Divide that out, that comes out to $12,500 for each one.
Which to me doesn't seem, I mean, possibly you could cut that down, but like $12,000 a person is, I think that's a reasonable amount of money to have.
You know, I'm actually shocked that you don't have it. But one of the people on that stage that you failed to mention was Huckabee, who raised a great point about being preemptive and finding research for diabetes, Alzheimer's,
sure,
and the other two things.
Yeah, preventative care is absolutely an important thing. But
and you didn't include it
because it's going to come up at another point. It's fine. It's Huckabee. But right, absolutely. I mean, sure. Now I'll give him right. That is true. But that's been something that Obama's talked about. A lot of people talk about that. Yes. It's not like a Huckabee idea. But yeah, of course, right. It's the difference between emergency room visits and checkups, like. Go for checkups so you don't have to just show up at the emergency room and be like, well, my spleen's broken. And they're like, do you have insurance? Well,
not at the moment.
I can tell you there are a lot of private sector things that you could do with $12,500, which will get you a lot more than you get from this government program.
That's really
a theme of a lot of the things that I'm talking about. How do we utilize our intellect rather than allowing the government to use its, quote, intellect in order to help us to be able to live healthier and better lives? It was never intended that the government should be in every aspect of our lives. This is a country that is up for and by the people.
All right. Thank you, sir. One more clip and then two closing statements and we're done.
We're done.
Chris, I'm going to give Christy the last word, apparently. I didn't
mean to. Wow.
Christy says the Republicans are batting around great ideas in a civil manner, unlike what you saw in the Democratic debate. It's not true. The Dem debate was almost entirely civil, filled with mostly issues, not how do you feel about. Rubio jumps in. He's such a candy ass, I wrote. All right. 139.25. I mean, and again, is that true? We watched the Democratic debate with everybody. We did all the clips. Is it really true that there was nothing
of substance? No.
Yeah, and that it was just they were insulting each other and not civil? That's crazy.
I'm pretty sure most of the people in attendance, though, did not even watch the other debate, so it's okay.
I don't know. I hope they did. All right, here we go.
They're going to give it back to you later, or would you rather take less later on?
Governor, do you also think that Dr. Carson's right, that we can replace Medicare with individual savings accounts?
No. What I said was that I think that Dr. Carson's ideas are good ideas. They're not my ideas, and I don't necessarily agree with all of them, but this is what you're seeing in the Republican debate that you didn't see in that Democrat debate. You didn't see it for a minute. You didn't see these kind of ideas being batted around and being batted around in a way that's civil and smart and that's trying to help to inform the voter out there.
I mean, first of all, okay, I got to step in there and then we'll finish the clip. Lincoln Chafee, I think at one point I said, respect, like the most respectful way I've ever seen anybody disagree with somebody was like, well, pardon me, and stepped in very civil. They chastised Bernie for shaking hands with Hillary and defending her. That's civility, dum-dums. Like now all of a sudden that didn't happen. None of that was there.
None of it happened.
It's crazy. Oh, didn't Bernie Sanders, Meghan McCain just show up as a hipster folk hero and throw the debate to Hillary? But wait, they also were fighting and being uncivil? I don't understand. They can't be doing both of those things.
They can be if two different people saw it that way.
Yeah, of course. Whatever's convenient at the time to say, that's what they're going to
yes,
say.
Yes, it is, my friend.
What you saw was a parade of, I'll give you this for free, I'll give you that for free. Let me tell you, everybody, when they say they want to give it to you for free, keep your hand on your wallet, because they're coming to you to pay for it. And that's why I think these ideas up here are great, and that's what we should have more discussions like this and less gotcha.
You know what, John, just want to give you
30
seconds here.
Sure. To take off from that point and argue the same thing, and that is that one of the things you're watching tonight are 11 quality candidates debating an important issue. The Republican Party's blessed to have 11 good candidates. If there are 10 good candidates, the Democrats can't even come up with one. And on this issue of Medicare in particular, it's important because they're going to demagogue what we're saying here tonight. Everyone up here tonight that's talking about reforms, I think, and I know for myself I speak for this, we're all...
What? For myself I speak for this?
You get the point.
He stumbled.
It happens.
I'll
but
let it go.
What he says is the important aspect, which is 100% true.
Well, apparently he's a candidate.
Let him say it.
Talking about reforms for future generations. Nothing has to change for current beneficiaries. My mother's on Medicare and Social Security. I'm against anything that's bad for my mother.
Damn right he is.
That's fine. I don't think that's what I was referring to. I think he says some more shit that makes me feel like he's a candy ass.
We're talking about reforms for people like me and people like Senator Cruz, as he talked about earlier, who are years away from retirement that have a way to plan for these changes in a way that's very reasonable. And it's not too much to ask of our generation after everything our parents and our grandparents did for us.
John,
that's the candy ass thing, which is like, my dad, a bartender. Look, he struggled. Shut up. It's the same. Whatever. You know what he's doing. It's political rhetoric. All right, two closing statements. We're out of here. I don't know why I picked Carly Fiorina's. I didn't write anything about it, but we'll just listen to it, and I'm sure we'll figure it out. This could be Fiorina's on the down slope here, I think.
You think going down?
Yeah.
Freedom.
Thank you, sir.
He ends his freedom. Shut up, Ted Cruz. And get on a treadmill, man.
Fiorina.
Too much tequila.
You know, every election, we hear a lot
too many pot brownies, apparently.
Yeah.
Talk, we hear a lot of good plans, we hear actually a lot of good intentions, but somehow for decades nothing really has changed. What we need now is a proven leader who has produced results.
Which I am.
That's how you go from secretary to CEO. You lead and you produce results. I will cut this government down to size and hold it accountable, simplify the tax code, roll back the regulations that have been spewing out of Washington, D.C. for 50 years. I may not be your dream candidate just yet, but I can assure you I'm Hillary Clinton's worst nightmare. And in your heart of hearts, you cannot wait to see a debate between Hillary Clinton and Carly Fiorina.
That was why
I will tell you this.
Yes.
I will beat Hillary Clinton. And with your votes and your support. And
I'll beat her like a South Carolina cop.
Nice.
By the way, the Zachary Hammond thing, I know it's like 6 hours later, but that's also in South Carolina. What the fuck's going on there? The Walter Scott thing was in South Carolina, I believe. She's not Hillary Clinton's worst nightmare.
Let's
get realistic. Hillary went through the goddamn 11-hour Benghazi whatever email bullshit. Like, she didn't flinch.
You want to know what I would wish that, like, in life, Carly would just go up to Hillary and go, "You want to do the debate now? Let's do it now." And they would actually just do it now.
Oh, it'd be great. I mean, it would make Hillary look likable.
They should reach out, because it would only help both of them.
Right, which is Hillary has no reason to do it. No, it could only hurt Hillary. In a complete fantasy that we're talking about,
yes,
it would. Hillary would have no reason to do that. It would help Fiorina, because it puts her on the same level as somebody who she's not on the same level
with.
Good point. Thank you, sir. Let's wrap this up, and then we'll close with old Donald Trump. Say our farewell to
You're
Trump.
You're going to end it with Trump?
I think he's done.
Your prayers. I will lead with the citizens of this great nation, the resurgence of this great nation.
Thank you.
She took a page out of your playbook. She said nation and nation. You shock and shock. So very good, Joey.
Yes.
You're an influencer. 145:45. Let me get there. This is Donald Trump's closing remark. And then we're going to wrap up the show.
Our country doesn't win anymore. We used to win. We don't win anymore. We lose on trade. We lose with ISIS. We lose with one of the worst deals I've ever seen negotiated of any kind. That's our recent catastrophe with Iran. we don't win. Let me give you one quick example. These folks, CNBC, they had it down at three and a half hours. I just read today in the New York Times, $250,000 for a 30-second ad. I went out and said, it's ridiculous. Nobody, I could stand up here all night. Nobody wants to watch 3.5 or 3 hours. It was a big sacrifice, and I have to hand it to Ben. We called Ben. He was with me 100%. We called in. We said, that's it. We're not doing it. They lost a lot of money. Everybody said it couldn't be done. Everybody said it was going to be 3 hours, 3.5, including them. And in about 2 minutes, I renegotiated it down to 2 hours so we can get the hell out of here. Not bad. Not bad. And I'll do that with the country. We will make.
He's going to make the country less time. I don't know what his point is.
America, great again. And thank you, everybody.
Just for the record, the debate was always going to be 2 hours. Senator Rubio.
That's not right. That is absolutely not right. You know that. That is not right.
Senator Rubio.
Thank you.
All right. Well, so there you go. So that's a weird ending for Trump. I mean, he tried to like hit it hard and it just didn't work out in his favor. Joey, final thoughts about this debate?
I think...
Did any of that change your mind? The stuff that you didn't see, you know?
I think Rubio had a great showing. As
you do really think so?
Said, yes. And Bush imploded.
Yeah, Bush is not looking great. Shelby, you got any little thoughts about that debate?
I had never really paid attention to Rubio before this, but he really seems like he has it more together than a lot of them, and a lot more than I thought he did.
Sure, yeah, and that I think is the point. I think he's standing out, not necessarily because he's so spectacular. I think he's standing out because the rest of the crowd is not
doing so bad.
Yeah, and also now he got a little injection of cash. Not a little injection. He's probably got a lot of money coming his way, so he's got a little more confidence going on, and you know. But yeah, that's a fair point.
I really wish the next debate you could vote somebody off, or if they don't get enough votes, they can't
well,
do
are
the
kinda,
next debate.
You are kind of voting them off, right? Where's Santorum? No. He's gone. Huckabee's going to be gone. Like, these guys are going to miss a threshold.
How many more debates do we have to get through until we start seeing them drop like flies?
I don't know. It's going to be interesting. Again, once a vote gets cast, then it's okay. Forget it. I'm out. Is Bush even going to make it to Iowa? These are all questions.
I don't believe so.
Yeah, we'll see what happens. I mean, that certainly didn't help him. No. I think if he... Yeah, I guess he's just not that great a candidate. But Rubio, yeah, is certainly going to be
a force to be reckoned with.
Possibly, sure. All right, everybody. Thank you so much for listening to the program. We had a song prepared, but in the fullness of time, I'll explain why we're not going to be playing songs anymore. But we are not going to be playing songs anymore. And I'm actually probably going to go back into the back catalog and cut those songs out. I'll tell you more when you guys need to know what's going on. But that's it. So I'm just letting you know, we're not going to play a song. We are not going to play Adele's Hello, which, my God, I can't stop listening to. I love it.
Play what?
Adele's song, Hello.
Oh, okay.
It's a wonderful piece of musicianship.
I haven't heard it yet.
Are you mental? All right, well, I'll play it for you after this.
Oh, thank you.
Everyone, thank you so much for you're like, no, not mental because I didn't hear Adele's song. SoundCloud.com/MandatorySampson. You can go on there, subscribe, leave a comment on the track. I always respond to those. It's great. YouTube.com/MandatorySampson. All the full episode videos go up. I put them up. I sync them with the audio that you're used to listening to on SoundCloud. So it sounds the same, but you just get the visual element. Like when we, you know, watch all the debate clips, you can see it. And you can see the videos that we play. Shit, I wanted to say something else about that. Oh, yeah. There's also a playlist called Livestream Link. You can watch the live stream every Thursday at 4 p.m. Do it all. YouTube.com/MandatorySampson. Email us, MandatorySampson@gmail.com. Thank you, everyone who sent emails. I appreciate it. I respond to all those. And it's really nice to get some feedback, positive or negative, but most of it's positive, and I really appreciate it. Twitter, I'm @ManSamp. Joey?
I'm Joey from Jersey with the Z.
You can also get in touch with those same handles on Snapchat. And I think that's the whole story. Joey, got any last words here?
Very nicely done, Chris.
Thank you. I really appreciate your work today. Shelby, thank you very much. Evan, thank you for doing research over there. And we love you guys. We'll talk to you next week.